The first opening statement will be Dinesh D'Souza for 15 minutes. You ready? Very good.
I am delighted and honored to be here. I'm looking forward to a lively debate. In fact, thinking about this and thinking about our election season, I was remembering back to 1984. You might remember some of the, well, some of you won't remember, the Reagan-Mondale debates. There wasn't much of a debate, really. Reagan would speak and Mondale would make accusations and Reagan would ignore him. Finally, one of the reporters, Andrea Mitchell, said, President Reagan, what do you think of Mondale's charges? And Reagan said, I think he should pay them. Walks off. Well, we sometimes have special occasions and weeks, Black History Month and so on. For me, this has been something I like to call Atheist Bashing Week, because I've actually been doing several debates this week, but it's culminating in this one. And I want to welcome Peter Singer, because in some ways I think that in making this case, he represents the sharpest, perhaps in some ways the deepest, certainly the most lucid, and in a very profound way, the most consistent in arguing out the premises and the implications of atheism. Peter Singer is a controversial figure, and it's not entirely surprising. He has advanced theses that have caused a little bit of shock. He has argued, for example, that not only should abortion be permitted to the moment of pregnancy, but people should be able to kill their infants up to the age of 28 days, essentially without restriction. He has also argued that other cultures kill their children at much further ages, 1 year, 2 years, 5 years old. He says we can actually learn from these cultures with a view to perhaps adopting some of their practices. He's also argued in favor of euthanasia, which is the killing of people who are old and in a sense have ceased to get very much out of life, perhaps. And then somewhat paradoxically, he is also a champion of animal rights. In fact, he has argued that even the fish and the rats may have more consciousness, more awareness of their surroundings, and in some senses have a better claim to life than handicapped humans who don't have that kind of awareness. Now, when he argues these things, people usually get horrified and they gasp and they say, how can you think this? So they think he's kidding. But I want to suggest, actually, that we should calm down and take a hard look at what he's saying, because really, I think what he's trying to show us is the logical implications of a purely secular society. Now, what I mean by this is that we all think we know what a secular society looks like. We have, in a sense, 1 foot in secular society. Europe is, we think, a secular society, but no. Our society, and certainly Western civilization, remains imbued, in some ways drenched, with Christian assumptions. Even people who think they are acting in secular ways are often reflecting those assumptions. We need to think hard of what it would be like in a society where you have completely removed God from the picture. Now, this is what I take to be Peter Singer's argument, and I'm stating it not completely to disagree with it. I'm going to comment on it after I state it. I think he's saying, in a sense, that if God is dead, and he thinks God is dead, then Christian morality is based on a myth. And so having killed God, it's not enough to stop there. You've got to work it through and get rid of all the Christian morality that comes out of that Christian God. So, for example, the idea that we've long had in the West of the preciousness and equal dignity of human life, he thinks that needs to go. The specialness of human life, human beings, in a sense, differentiated in some ways, having rights, for example, that are not extended to other living creatures. This idea of life as unique, human life as special, he thinks that we should get rid of that one. The prohibition against the deliberate killing of the innocents. This has been a bedrock principle of Western civilization. It is an emanation of Christianity. He would like us to move beyond it. In some senses, what Peter Singer is saying is that either we are the special creation of God, or we are Darwinian primates. Since we are Darwinian primates, we've got to recognize that Christianity is a myth. Christianity came into the world, and it took human beings, and it put them on this pedestal. It said, God loves you. God, in a sense, created everything because of you. You have special dignity, special worth, special rights. And in a sense, Singer is saying, now we've got to move away from all that. We've got to knock man off his pedestal and bring him down. And also automatically the position of the animals moves up. So the one may say the Darwinian natural continuum is thereby restored. Now, if all of this seems a little bizarre, I actually want to suggest that I agree completely with this argument. If the premise is true, the conclusions do indeed follow. Now, other leading atheists, people like Christopher Hitchens, Richard Dawkins, and others, I've been debating some of them, and they often say, listen, we can be good without God. We can preserve Christian morality without the Christian God. We can retain compassion. We can retain the value of human life. We can retain the equal dignity of women. We can just get rid of, if you will, the divine foundation. Richard Dawkins has even called himself a cultural Christian. I take Peter Singer to be arguing that this view is a complete illusion. And in this sense, I'm on Peter Singer's side of the debate. I want to say very briefly why. One way we can look at the distinctive heritage of Christianity is you just have to look to ancient Greece and Rome. I'm talking about pre-Christian Rome, before Christianity. First of all, the ancient Spartans, very famously, if the child was sick or unwanted or feeble, they would leave it on the hillside and be quite happy to find it dead in the morning. This is not actually so shocking. What is shocking is the great thinkers of ancient Greece, Plato, Aristotle, knew about this and viewed it with relative equanimity. Now why? That's because the idea of the worth or sacredness of human life, this was simply not a big value in ancient Greece and Rome. Infanticide was in fact quite common in those societies. Slavery was very common in ancient Greece and Rome. And some people say, well, didn't it continue under Christianity? Well, not really. In fact, between the 3rd and the 10th centuries, slavery was eradicated from most of Europe. And then later, you had strong anti-slavery or abolition movements largely motivated by Christianity. The Quakers, the evangelical Christians, basically said if we are created equal in the eyes of God, a theological point, then no man has the right to rule another man without his consent. And this idea became the basis not only of anti-slavery or abolition, it also became the basis of democracy, which is based on the very same principle. No man has the right to rule another without consent. Or look at the idea of compassion. Aristotle makes a list of the virtues. Compassion does not appear on that list. In some ways, Aristotle saw it more as a vice. So compassion is a value that came into the world because of Christianity. In a sense, I take Peter Singer to be arguing that we need not so much to go forward as to go back to that kind of a pre-Christian world in which life is valued not so much for itself as an end in itself, but as a means. As a means, if you will, to Darwinian primates trying to make their way in the world. Now, I said earlier that we think we know about secular society, but in fact, historically, there have been very few secular societies, if any. But we have had great experiments in secularism in the last century, in the 20th century, where for the first time you had thinkers and leaders who tried to implement, you might say, secular utopia. Yes, I'm thinking, for example, of Mao in China. I'm thinking of Stalin in Russia. I'm thinking of the Nazi regime in Germany, but not just those three. I'm thinking of Pol Pot in Indochina, Enver Hoxha, Kim Jong-il, Fidel Castro. Numerous experiments to do what? In a sense, to create a new man and a new utopia liberated from the shackles of traditional religion and traditional morality. Now, some people like to say, well, what about the crimes of religion? But quite interestingly, the crimes of religion, even the crimes of radical Islam, are infinitesimal when compared to the crimes, one may say, of trying to create the atheist secular society. The Inquisition, for example, over a period of 350 years, managed to kill some 2,000 people. Pol Pot, in the space of 3 years, and he doesn't even make it into the top tier of atheists, he killed about 3 million people in the space of just a few years. Altogether, the atheist regimes have killed well in excess of 100 million people. So they have spilled an ocean of blood and a mountain of bodies, all done, we may say, to create this secular utopia. Now, my conclusion is that it is atheism and not religion that is really responsible for the mass murders of history. Now, Peter Singer, I think, will rightly say, listen, don't equate me with the Nazis, don't equate me with the communists, I'm not proposing the kind of stuff they did. And in a sense, he is quite right. The Nazi regime, the communists, this was state-sponsored murder. This was killing by the state. Peter Singer doesn't want killing by the state. He wants killing by the individual. In other words, he doesn't want the government to kill people. He wants you and me and him to make those decisions for ourselves. Against the communist and fascist alternative, you might say, of totalitarian genocide, he offers a very interesting democratic alternative: free market homicide. Now, Dostoevsky, a long time ago, said in The Brothers Karamazov, if God is not, everything is permitted. I think what Dostoevsky meant by this is two things. One is, if you remove the idea of God from the world, there's no ultimate accountability. If you remove the idea of God from the world, there's no last judgment. There's not even the Hindu reincarnation in which you say to someone, you behave badly in this life, well, I guess we'll see you as a cockroach in the next one. If you remove the idea of God, you can get away with it if you aren't caught. And moreover, if you remove the idea of God, the other human being ceases to be God's creation, ceases to be in some way special, becomes, if you will, a means to our end. The philosopher Nietzsche contemplated this situation, and he made the following thought. He said, listen, there are many people in our society who want to eradicate God, but if you will, keep the other principles of Western civilization, the principle of abolition, the principle of the equal dignity of women, the principle of compassion, the value of human life. Nietzsche felt it was an illusion. It's not going to happen. It'll take a little time, but ultimately those values will erode, and we're going to see terrible massacres in their wake. We have seen those massacres. We don't have to theorize about them. They've already happened. In some ways, I think what Peter Singer is projecting is what a democratic society, what a free society would look if it adopted these atheist principles and applied them to our own given situation. I want to suggest that we should think carefully. We better think not just twice, but three times and maybe four before we go down that bloodstained road. If God is not, everything is indeed permitted. Thank you very much.
Peter Singer, 15 minutes.
Thank you very much. I'm not going to start by responding to the things that Dinesh D'Souza has said, because my understanding is that we're here to debate the existence of God, not the details of my ethical views. I'm very happy to defend them and perhaps correct some of the misinterpretations or false impressions that you might have received from what Dinesh D'Souza has said, but that's not the subject of our debate. Let's talk about whether we ought to believe God exists. That's surely the starting point. Even if you think that the consequences of atheism are not going to be good, Dinesh D'Souza obviously does, I don't, as I will say a little bit more about later, still, you surely ought to be interested in the basic question, does God exist or not? And we haven't really heard any argument in the 15 minutes opening statement for that, except that if we don't believe it, the consequence is going to be bad. But, you know, sometimes things are true, even though we don't like the consequences of them. We all know that. If a doctor tells someone you love, perhaps even yourself, that you have cancer and will probably only have 6 months to live, you don't say, oh, that would be terrible, I would hate that, so it can't be true. You need to look at the evidence as to whether that is true or not. That's what I want to do. Now, when we're talking about God, of course, that concept can mean a lot of different things to a lot of different people. Since this is a Christian institution, since I know that Dinesh D'Souza is a Christian, and since we are living in a society that is Christian in its culture, I'm essentially going to talk about the Christian or the Judeo-Christian conception of God. And that's the being that I think I can claim does not exist. There may be other things in the universe people can talk about, you know, some vague life force or whatever, which it's much more difficult to prove or disprove it's the existence of such a being. But of the Christian, the Judeo-Christian God, I think we can be clear that that being does not exist, and the reason we can be clear about that is by looking at the world around us. The world around us contains an immensity of suffering. As far as we know, it always has contained, as long as there have been sentient beings, which goes back many millions of years, an immensity of suffering. Can we really believe that a God who is described as all-powerful, all-knowing, and all-good has created such a world? I think this is the major stumbling block to belief in the Christian God. It's always been, for me, the thing that has made it impossible for me to believe in such a God. A God who created, who deliberately and knowingly created a world like this one, could not be a good being. We might say either this kind of God was evil, or this God was a bungler. There are no other options. But Christians, of course, deny either of those alternatives. Now, this is a very old argument, of course. I'm not saying anything at all novel. You all know it. You're probably all familiar with it. Despite the fact that it's an old argument, generally, Christians have not had very satisfactory responses. And I think, in fact, that Dinesh also, in his book, What's So Great About Christianity, does not say anything very much about it. He has a very few pages on this topic at all, and really only gets to the tough problem in a paragraph or two, which not surprisingly is not satisfactory. What do Christians usually say about it? Well, the most common response, I suppose, is to say, yes, there is suffering in the world, but there is suffering. Dinesh, in fact, listed a lot of this suffering and the crimes of the atheists that he talked about, some of whom maybe were not actually all atheists, but anyway, talked about the things that people have done. And so most Christians say, well, God gave us free will. Free will is somehow seen as a great gift, as something that is essential, and indeed the importance of which in some way overrides all the suffering that Dinesh mentioned, and indeed all the suffering that humans have created in the world. Now, I think we might question whether giving humans free will is worth it, given what many of them have done with their free will. But let's just leave that. Let's just accept that claim, if you like. Let's just accept that somehow it was so important that we should have free will, that God could give us free will, knowing in advance that the Nazis would murder 6 million innocent people, that Stalin would murder 20 million innocent people, that Pol Pot would murder 20% of the population of his country, and so on and so forth. Let's assume that God nevertheless did that. It is still the case that there is a lot of suffering in the world that is not explained by this, because there is a lot of suffering in the world that is nothing to do with anyone's free will. We all know that. We've all seen it. We've all seen natural disasters, earthquakes, floods, tsunamis, droughts, diseases. which strike people down, cause them to suffer, cause them to die, sometimes horrible, agonizing deaths, drawn-out deaths, or cause them to live in unspeakable afflictions, agony, constantly hungry or thirsty because of a drought, perhaps, that has caused crops to fail. And we can't explain that in terms of free will. It has nothing to do with free will. Nor can we explain it in terms of saying that we are fallen, as Christians tend to say, and therefore none of us are innocent. Because even if you believe that, and let me say, I think it would be a totally monstrous doctrine to believe that God would create a world in which, let's say, a two-year-old child would die a slow and lingering death from hunger and thirst because that baby's alleged ancestors, Adam and Eve, sinned. Again, I would think that would be a monstrous God who could make a baby suffer for that reason. But even if you still think that, even if you still think that the suffering of that baby is somehow deserved because of original sin, what about the suffering of non-human animals? They also die slow, miserable deaths through droughts or hunger or disease or a variety of other causes. And not even Christians believe that they suffer from original sin. They're not descended from Adam. And that suffering has been going on even longer than human suffering, because they've been sentient beings, sentient animals, for even longer. I think it's inexplicable on the Christian account of the world that animals should suffer in those ways. And I have to say, I could not possibly worship, I could not possibly revere a God who did that. If somehow it were proved to me that there is such a God, an all-powerful God, my attitude would have to be one of contempt and defiance, whatever it cost me. I think I would not have any integrity if I worshiped such a God simply because he was all-powerful when he was such a monster. Now again, of course, some Christians have been aware of all of this that I'm saying. What do they say? Well, actually, the only answer that seems to me even remotely to really answer the question was given by René Descartes, the 17th century French philosopher, who said, well, this is a big problem. This is a terrible problem, animal suffering, for belief in Christianity, but I have the answer. I can solve this problem which no one else can solve. And you know what his answer was? His answer was, animals don't suffer. They're just machines. He said, look, your clock makes a noise, but that doesn't mean it's conscious. It's just a machine. Animals are machines made by God. A bit more complicated, of course, because God made them, not just us. So the noises they make, the fact that they cry out or yelp or whine when they're hurt, doesn't mean that they suffer. They're just complicated machines. Well, if you can believe that, okay, you can get away from the problem of evil. But I don't think many people who live with a dog or a cat or know anything about animals could possibly believe that. And I don't think there's any other plausible solution to the problem of evil. Okay, let me just say a few more things in the time that I have remaining. If somehow I were to come to believe in God, I could still not possibly think that the account of Jesus as given by the Gospels is an account of a being who I would want to regard as part of God or the Son of God or whatever particular view of the Trinity you may hold. It seems to me clear that the Gospels present an image of a person who, firstly, was mistaken about the future, deeply mistaken about the second coming. It must be evident, I think, to anyone who reads the Gospels and takes them at all in their obvious face value meaning, that Jesus believed the second coming would occur in the lifetime of those, or some of those, to whom he was speaking. He says it on several occasions. You can find it in Mark and Matthew. I'm sure many of you will know the verses better than I do. That some of you here will not have tasted death before the coming. It didn't happen. Take it, that's not news to any of you. It didn't happen. Paul also said something similar, clearly expected it to happen. It didn't happen. Christians have been saying it ever since. It didn't happen. Christians are still saying it. They're constantly setting new dates for when it's going to happen. It doesn't happen. Well, I'm not focusing on the current Christians, but Jesus clearly was mistaken about that. And if you want to take the gospel seriously, then I think you have to admit he was wrong. Of course, you could have some figurative interpretation of it. He didn't mean it literally. But once you do that, anything goes. Once you have those kind of metaphorical interpretations of the Gospels, we can all argue about the messages of the Gospels in a variety of different ways. Let me also say that I think the image of God given in the Old Testament is, if anything, considerably worse. The God in the Old Testament seems to quite openly embrace exactly the crimes that Dinesh accused atheists of carrying out, namely genocide. Have a look at Numbers 31, if you don't believe me. It's not something that's probably read regularly in church. But God tells Moses to strike against the Midianites, people whose women have been sleeping with some Israelites and have led them to worship the Midianite god. So the Israelites arm themselves, they go out, they attack the Midianites, they kill all the Midianite men, they carry off their cattle, they burn their villages, and then they bring the women and children back in front of Moses. And Moses, who's been instructed by God on what he should do, gets angry with them and says, "What? Did you spare the women? They're the ones who induced our Israelites to worship the false gods. So kill all the women who have known men, all the non-virgins, in other words. Kill them all. And kill all the male children. Slaughter all the male children, who are completely innocent, obviously, small children. The only ones you don't slaughter are the virgins. Them take for yourselves." That's what God instructs the Israelites to do. Can we seriously worship such a God if we believe in him? I think it's better to regard this as a kind of a myth, a fairy tale, a national stories made up by a warring primitive tribe than the revealed word of God. So now let me just say I'll make one point in response to what Dinesh said about morality, and I'll perhaps come back to it in later rebuttal. Dinesh said that compassion came into the world because of Christianity. He's historically wrong. If you know anything at all about Buddhism, you will know that compassion is a basic principle. Compassion not only for humans, incidentally, but for all sentient beings, is a first principle of Buddhism. And if you know your history, you know that Buddhism existed about 500 years before Jesus. So compassion didn't come into the world because of Christianity. Christianity may have spread it in certain areas where Buddhism didn't. I'm not going to say that Christianity has been bad in every respect. It certainly hasn't. But we can certainly have compassionate atheists because, in fact, Buddhists don't believe in God. They are atheists in the strict sense of the term. And yet, compassion is very important for them. And I would defy anyone to say that, in general, Christians are more compassionate than Buddhists are, though I'm not a Buddhist. I don't carry any particular baggage for Buddhism, but it's simply a fact on the record. It's also interesting that despite the alleged moral virtues of Christianity, the United States does not seem to be a more virtuous nation than the more secular nations of Europe or Australia. Okay, just to finish my sentence. If you look, for example, the Times had an article just last week the prison population of the United States. The United States has 5% of the world's population. It has 25% of the world's prisoners, inmates. I'll rest with that.
Thank you very much. Each debater will have a 5-minute rebuttal. Dinesh.
Well, on the issue of Buddhism, if there's a famine tomorrow in Rwanda, you'll notice something very interesting, which is to say the Western nations will rush to help, send volunteers, the churches will send food, Doctors Without Borders, there'll be people writing checks. You'll notice that in the other cultures of the world, there's a relative indifference, including cultures that have been influenced by Buddhism. Buddhism, of course, rejected in the land of its birth, India, and for many centuries having a very thin imprint on the world. So compassion as a practical matter embedded itself in Western civilization. There was an idea of it in Buddhism, but it was not really taken up by anyone. Now, with regard to the business about, the evidence of God, I don't want this to be a debate of two ships passing in the night, so I'm gonna offer a couple of quick arguments because I then want to address Peter Singer's specific claims about suffering. We know we live in a universe that had a beginning. Now, everything that has a beginning, every material thing that has a beginning, has a cause. What is the cause of the universe? What is the cause for which the universe is an effect? You might say, could it be a natural cause? No, because the universe encompasses all that is natural. If something caused the universe, it would have to be something non-natural or, to put it somewhat differently, supernatural. This would be my first argument for the existence of a designer. Second, a universe is, you may say, fine-tuned for life. And what I mean by this is that our universe, not just our planet, but our entire universe has to be as old as it is and as big as it is and have the precise numerical values it does, the electromagnetic force, the gravitational force, the strong nuclear force, the so-called electroweak force. Stephen Hawking, in his book A Brief History of Time, says that if you touch one of those numerical dials, he's talking about the rate of expansion of the universe, and you move it, not 10%, not 1%, one part in 100,000 million million, you would have no universe. You would have no life. Our entire universe appears to be a kind of conspiracy to produce, you might say, us, beings that can contemplate such a universe. This argument has put atheism on the complete defensive. There is no alternative explanation of such a fine-tuned universe that makes more sense than to posit an intelligent creator. Finally, morality. What's interesting is that we are supposed to be Darwinian primates, and yet we have within us this unshakable conviction that we should frequently act against our self-interest. I'm walking in the riverbank. I hear someone shout, "Help, help, help." I'm not a very good swimmer. If I want to perpetuate my genes, I'll keep walking. That's not my wife or my daughter. That guy's no one to me. And yet if I keep walking, a little voice in my head says, "No, you really should try to help him. But I can't swim that well." This voice that we can't avoid. We all have it. In fact, if we don't have it, we're sociopaths or psychopaths. The person who has no morality, no conception of it. And this morality frequently militates against self-interest. It has no Darwinian explanation. Where does this objective morality come from? Where does the moral law derive from, if not from a moral lawgiver? Now, I want to say a couple of things about suffering. I won't be able to do full justice to it in the time I have, but I'm happy to come back to it. The first point I want to make is that the atheists love to throw the argument about suffering as if they invented it. Actually, they got it out of the book of Job. This is an argument that Christians are not only familiar with, but have thought harder about than the sort of glib assertions of, well, what happens to the guy who was born with one arm, or the child with cancer, and so on. In Job's case, a tremendous reversal of fortunes, a very sophisticated argument. Call it imaginative, if you will. Nevertheless, its intellectual content substantial. But, so that's the first point. We've thought about it. Second, Hidden in Peter Singer's articulation of this argument is a Christian assumption. Because if you think about it, his whole argument was based upon caring. He essentially said, what about the child who gets cancer? What about the animal who suffers? The first question to ask is, if we are Darwinian primates, who cares? Why on earth would a dog care if a cat gets bitten? Why on earth would we, if our goal in life is to perpetuate our genes and promote our own self-interest, we would be relatively indifferent, particularly to the sufferings of strangers? Of course, if it's our relatives, you could say we share their genes. So I want to suggest that this presumption that we care is itself a legacy of theism, because it presumes that the other person like us has dignity. The other person like us is a creation, one may say, that has value in and of itself. That even though we don't suffer, we should nevertheless extend, if you will, empathy to this other creature. Peter Singer's been writing for years about animal rights. He's been pretty successful in winning converts. Unfortunately, all those converts are human. He hasn't been successful in getting animals to respect animal rights. Now, how am I doing on time? All right.
Okay, let me just say that that last line about I haven't got animals converted, you know, maybe it was good for a laugh and a hand. I think it's cheap, I have to say. I think it's seriously cheap. Why is it cheap? Because I never thought I could convert animals. I know that animals are different from us. I know that animals are not capable of listening to rational argument. It's implying that somehow I've made some sort of mistake where I never had. Of course that animals are different from us. Anybody who's read my work knows that I don't think animals are the same as us. I simply think that they have interests, they're capable of suffering, and we do wrong when we ignore their interests simply because they're not members of our species. It's also incidentally wrong to say that animals don't care. I think, again, anyone who knows dogs well will know that they do care about what happens to, perhaps what happens to you. There's many anecdotes about many different species who care about their own kind and others. So caring is not part of theism. They're not theists. Caring is something that is natural to us. Now, it's true that it may often be more limited. It may be true that since we are beings who have higher rational abilities, we can care more universally. Nothing in that that's contrary to assumptions of Darwin or of evolution, that we are rational beings who can understand better than non-rational beings what it's like for someone in Rwanda to suffer. That's certainly true. There's nothing contrary to evolution or Darwin in that. And incidentally, when Dinesh says, well, the Christians will write checks and the Buddhists won't, I suspect that's a slur. What's certainly true is that three of the greatest philanthropists in the history of the United States and the two greatest living philanthropists in the United States who have given more than anyone else to fighting global poverty have not been religious. I'm talking about Bill Gates and Warren Buffett. They have given vastly more than anyone else, vastly more than any Christian in the history of the world has ever given to fight global poverty. And the third person I was thinking of is Andrew Carnegie, who also, in terms of inflation-adjusted dollars, would be close to being up there, though not quite, with Gates and Buffett. Also not a religious person. So there's plenty of atheists who help, and I certainly believe we should do a lot more to help. So a lot of my writings has talked about what we ought to be doing to help the hungry and the poor in the world. And I give a substantial portion of my income to do that. I dare say that I give more than 99% of Christians in this country give. And I know that many other people do as well. Now, look quickly at the arguments. It's not actually clear that our universe has a beginning. Dinesh says this, and he talks, of course, about the Big Bang. But if you really look at what a physicist says, physicists are really talking about the known or observable universe. If you talk to physicists who study the Big Bang, and I've talked to Professor Lyman Page at Princeton University, who is one of the greatest experts in this area. In fact, he's the one who, through measuring cosmic background radiation, has done more to precisely date the Big Bang than anyone else. And he will acknowledge that he's just talking about the universe that we observe now. He does not know, and science does not know, what happened before the Big Bang. But I think it's clear that there was a universe. It's hard to imagine nothing existing and the bang occurring out of nothing. And it's possible, as some have suggested, that there's a constant oscillation of expansion and collapse of the universe. So the universe may well, I would suggest, probably has existed forever. And if it hasn't, of course, you have to say, Dinesh has to say, that God has existed forever. But that's just as implausible, just as difficult to imagine, I would say, as the universe existing forever. So there's certainly no favouring for a theistic view there. At best, it's a tie. The universe, The universe is supposed to be fine-tuned for life. Well, very briefly, not necessarily so. A lot of scientists think, again, Lyman Page thinks, that these claims, that, like the one from Hawking that Dinesh quoted, are simply false. That you could vary these things quite a bit, and you would have perhaps different universes, but you would have universes capable of life. And of course, since we are here, we know that we live in a universe that is one capable of supporting life. Otherwise, we simply wouldn't be here to observe it. Let me leave it at that. Thank you.
We're now going to move into cross-examination. If you've never seen this before, let me just explain a little bit about it. Each of the debaters will ask the other questions and will rely on their gentlemanly attitudes to keep their responses to the point and short and allow the other person to ask a question after they're finished answering. We will start as our usual pattern. Dinesh D'Souza, why don't you ask the first question in the section of cross-examination, and we'll go on for about 15 or 16 minutes with this.
Let's begin. I want to come back to some of the themes I raised at the very beginning, because you've sort of ignored them, really, and move on to talk about suffering and other things. So let me ask you this question. Let's assume that society moved in the direction that you want. We're a secular society. We've eliminated the idea of God. And now someone proposes a law to deal with some of the people in our society who are physically and mentally handicapped. And the law basically says that if you've got people who are so handicapped that they don't have their full faculties, they can't live a very meaningful life, and they have no family, they have become dependent on the state. So the idea is to get those people together and give them all lethal injections. And this is a proposition that goes before the Supreme Court. They call you in to offer not just legal, but also ethical advice. Would you advise against this, and if so, why?
Well, as you have described the law, I would advise against it, but you haven't described it very precisely. Because you've talked about people who are handicapped or intellectually disabled. You haven't said, for example, whether they are infants.
Let's make it more precise. Let's take people who have Alzheimer's disease, who in a sense have no real comprehension of life. In that sense, they've lost, as you say, not only the ability to consciously enjoy the past, the present, they have no projection in the future. Let's say the proposal is lethal injection for all people with Alzheimer's who have no family. Are you for it or against it, and why?
I'm against it because people with Alzheimer's have had a period of life when they have been, like you and me, capable of deciding how they want to live and how they want to die. And if they fill in a statement saying that when they get Alzheimer's, they no longer want to go on living, I would be in favor of passing a law that said that someone could give them a lethal injection when they reach the point that they have described in their document, you know, before witnesses, perhaps with a cooling off period, come back to it a week or two later or something like that. I would be in favor of a law that allowed someone to do what they had requested under those circumstances. But I would not be in favor of a law that ended the lives of people who had had a chance to think about that and who had not requested that form of ending their life.
But aren't you injecting new data into my example? I was talking about people who haven't made any such statements.
Yes, well, that's why I opposed the law.
Okay, so you would require... Okay, go ahead. Now it's your turn.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, you said that I had not responded to the questions that you said in your beginning, but that's because I thought we were focusing on the existence of God. I don't believe that you have responded to the argument from evil, the argument about suffering. You did say that this is not original, that indeed it's in the book of Job. I know that. You did say that, it presupposes that we care, and you think Darwinians shouldn't care, but there's a lot more I can say about that. I think we are capable of caring. We have empathy for others, and we have the capacity to extend that to strangers because of our higher cognitive abilities. So many of us, even though we're atheists, do care, and that's understandable. You still haven't told me how it can be that a world with this kind of suffering, not caused by human free will, could be created by an all-powerful, all-knowing, and all-good divinity.
Well, first of all, it seems to me that this argument is less an argument about the existence of God and more an argument about the nature of God. In other words, you seem to be saying, if God did it, he's really a mean God. Right? You're not challenging the existence of God. You're simply saying his character is, from your point of view, deficient, because if you were God, you would have done it differently.
I started off by saying that I thought we were debating the Christian or Judeo-Christian concept of God. Isn't it true that that concept does mean that God has the attributes that I mentioned?
Well, our debate is God, yes or no. We're exploring the implications of theism and atheism. And so we, as we discussed earlier, we can interpret this any way we want. Now, I'm happy to address the points you raised. Look, in a sense, you could say God could have created a lawful universe, or he could have created an arbitrary universe. A lawful universe is a universe which operates according to physical laws. Science would be impossible if we didn't have a lawful universe, for example. So you seem to be suggesting God would have done better to create a discretionary universe in which, for example, if the ocean tide is rising and a tsunami is brewing, God jumps in like a cosmic bellboy, puts a stop to it, right?
Well, that's one possibility, but I can think of others which would have eliminated suffering or greatly reduced
unnecessary suffering. Is it possible to eliminate suffering and still have a lawful universe, according to you?
I would have thought God could do that. It would be, pretty easy, I would have thought, for an all-powerful being to create a...
Pretty easy.
Yeah, I would have thought so.
You would have thought so. Okay. Look, see, I think that in criticizing God, and the Christian God in particular, you first have to articulate the Christian understanding of the situation and then criticize that. It seems to me you're creating, if you will, an atheist God and then knocking that God down. Here's what I mean by that. From the Christian point of view, we are pilgrims on this earth. Our life is short. Eternal life is the ultimate destination. And so suffering and earthly suffering is not the be-all and end-all. In a sense, if a child has cancer and God were to jump in and fix the cancer, that child would still die. So if you say that God's ultimate concern is not simply terrestrial death but salvation, then from that point of view, none of this has the quality of self-evident refutation that you think it has. The larger question becomes, what is the larger pattern of human destiny? And so from the Christian point of view, all you are doing is saying that because there's earthly suffering, when earthly suffering is not the final picture, nevertheless, that convinces you, but only within an atheist, a pre-existing atheist framework, that there is no God.
Can I respond, or is it your turn for a question? I don't want to jump in if...
Well, let me take my turn, and then you'll have yours.
Okay, all right.
I want to come back a little bit to Gates and Buffett and the Carnegies and so on. First of all, Carnegie, as you know, wrote very explicitly on Christianity. His book, The Gospel of Wealth, for example, talks specifically about stewardship, Christian responsibility. But even Gates and Buffett, are you denying that these men are a product of a Christian civilization, Christian education? Are you denying that the assumptions of Athens and Jerusalem are imbued in our culture so that even secular people would be exposed to them? Are you denying that in some senses modern philanthropy, which by the way is a real peculiarity of Western civilization, in many other cultures people accumulate enormous wealth and don't feel any obligation to give any of it away, let alone most of it away. So this impulse, I think, historically, philosophically, can't be understood divorced from its religious foundations, can it?
Look, of course it's true that Buffett and Gates are the products of a Western civilization which has been dominated for the last 2,000 years by Christianity. You actually said, interestingly, Athens and Rome, and of course I think it's true that the influence of Athens, ancient Greece, has been important. And for Aristotle, magnanimity was a virtue, that is, and that includes, you know, giving things away, being generous, is part of that, not exactly Christian compassion. I would agree with you with that. It's a different conception. But it's nevertheless significant, I think, that these people, both of whom have said publicly that they don't really have a lot of time for religion, they're really not interested in it, have been the ones who have, undoubtedly given most of the wealth. So I think it's clear that, you know, though Christianity may have been a good influence in various ways, I'm not denying that, and some things of it are noble and should be picked up and preserved, it's clearly not necessary to be a believer to be among the greatest philanthropists of our time. If I can now come back to what you were saying about suffering, you said it's not the be-all and end-all, that's salvation, we only live here for a short time. Look, even if I were to accept that, I would still think it was a bad thing that there is this unnecessary suffering in the world, in these, you know, children dying painfully and unnecessary. And most of us do believe that, because of course we do our best to stop it. So that suggests that we also think the world would be better without it. Yet it's still there. But even if I were to give you that and say, okay, it doesn't matter for beings who have eternal salvation, you kept talking about humans. You have still not addressed the point that animals suffer too in this world. And I don't think you believe, or Christians believe, that they have an eternal life and have the prospect of salvation. So you still haven't explained why animals suffer in this world.
Well, earlier you chided me, but the point I was trying to make is that animals are primarily responsible for the suffering of other animals, aren't they?
No.
In other words, no. You wouldn't haven't you watched the Nature Channel?
Yeah. It's interesting that the Nature Channel does not go somewhere where there's a drought, parts of southeastern Australia at the moment, where I come from, for example, and have long lingering shots of kangaroos who are dying of thirst because the creeks have dried up. Doesn't make good television.
Well, look.
Happens, though.
You're talking about things being right and wrong, good and evil, and the point I was suggesting earlier is these concepts have no meaning in a Darwinian universe. This is the point I was getting at. The idea of objective good and objective evil presumes the existence of external morality, a standard by which you can confidently say, in the belief that all these people will agree with you, that there is such a thing as right and wrong. So even suffering, for all its mystery, seems to me in a certain way to be pointing to this unwavering standard, which is, in a sense, the product of God. In other words, the idea of an objective morality by which we judge. And here's another point I want to make. We see all this natural evil around us, and it seems to me that suffering is mainly not so much an intellectual problem as it is an emotional problem. If I lose my arm, it's not so much how did this happen, but rather how do I go on? If I lose a child, my biggest dilemma is what is the meaning of life? How can I keep living? It's ironic that for all the intellectual difficulties that one has in explaining suffering, when someone really suffers, a child has cancer, for example, or a mother loses a daughter, atheism has nothing to say to such a person, except things happen. On the other hand, the Christian, the theist, can address suffering, in make suffering perhaps meaningful, offer the suffering person hope. In that sense, it seems to me that theism and Christianity is offering something that people can really benefit from, some consolation, some expectation about the future. Meanwhile, the atheist, in a sense, has got to say nothing but, this is the way things are. Live with it.
Your question, I think.
Earlier, you, in talking about the universe, you offered some rather vague speculations. I mean, there's been 100 years of scientific progress that has coalesced around the idea of the Big Bang, the universe, if you will, having had that primordial moment, not just, by the way, the beginning of matter, but also, if you will, space and time coming into existence. Now, here's what I want to say, and that is, Isn't it the case that in, you said you've talked to a guy who's done some work on this, and you said it is possible to imagine. Christians are often accused of what you could call the God of the gaps. When you can't explain something, God did it. Aren't you resorting to what could be called the atheism of the gaps, in which if you can't explain something, you basically say, we'll explain later, science is figuring it out, go with the atheist assumption for now. In other words, to get rid of the simple explanation, God, you're basically waiting for atheism to kick in sometime in the future, aren't you?
I don't understand why it would be a simpler explanation to say that the world was created by a divine being who has existed forever than it would be to say that the universe has existed forever. It seems to me that to say the universe has existed forever is a simpler explanation. Now, your argument was that the universe actually hasn't existed forever, that science says there was a Big Bang, and this in some way supports the creationist account of the universe. All I'm saying is that science doesn't say that. Science only says the observable universe began 13 point something billion years ago, and with a kind of a bang, and has been expanding since. That's all it says, and that's all it can say. So I'm simply saying there is no argument here to believe that your hypothesis, that it was created by a divine being, is in any better shape than the hypothesis that it has always existed.
Well, you just said that the the observable universe is the universe we know. Are you saying, yes, that science can discern what occurs in unobservable universes?
Obviously not.
Exactly. So in other words, what I'm saying is, in order to avoid the implication of God, in order to abolish one unobservable God, you're inventing one or multiple unobservable universes, aren't you?
I'm not inventing it. I'm saying that it's a possibility that existed, just as it's a possibility that the God that you believe has existed. I'm simply saying there's no extra points for you on this side.
Well, your turn.
My question? Okay. Let me just say something about your claims about the crimes committed by atheists. I certainly agree, terrible crimes have been committed by atheists. You'll get no argument from me there. But I think terrible crimes have been committed by theists as well. We are aware of some very recent crimes committed by theists, Islamic rather than Christian theists. But that's certainly the result of strong religious faith, and I think it shows the dangers of strong religious faith in terms of what it can lead people to do. If we're adding up the numbers, the Inquisition may not have been big numbers. I think there are larger numbers that Christians have been responsible for destroying and enslaving. If you look at, for example, the Christians who conquered Mexico and Peru and the brutalities that they carried out and the ways they... this is not my time, I take it. This is our time that's up, isn't it? I'll just finish this question, and if we get... I think Dinesh should have a chance to answer. Right, okay, good. I think there are other large numbers of atrocities they've committed, and of course Christians have supported slavery historically. But let me just say one thing briefly then about the Nazis. Isn't it true that the German soldiers who went to advance the Nazi cause and the Nazi army wore belt buckles which said, engraved on them, Gott mit uns, God with us? Is this really compatible with the idea that Nazism was an atheist regime? And isn't it also true that the Nazis were cheered on, in many cases, by Christians? My parents were living in Vienna in 1938 when the Nazis invaded, and they were Jewish. And they remember that the Archbishop of Austria, Cardinal Innitzer, rang the church bells in celebration when the Nazis walked in. And when Hitler declared a referendum, of course not a free referendum, on the Anschluss, on the union of Austria and Germany, Cardinal Innitzer said, vote yes. So I think Christians bear a heavy responsibility, whether or not Hitler personally was a Christian. Maybe he wasn't. Maybe he was some kind of vague atheist. But I don't actually think he was an atheist, and I certainly think that Christians played a prominent role in the atrocities the Nazis committed. Although it's also true that some Christians heroically defied the Nazis and paid for it with their lives, as did some atheists.
Well, first of all, you says maybe, but Hitler, there is a book Hitler's Table Talk, which is a rather extensive compilation of Hitler's actual views as compiled by his close advisors. It's very clear, emphatically, that he hated Christianity. And in a sense, what he was trying to do is replace, if you will, traditional Christian society with a new race utopia. The leading figures around Hitler, Himmler, Goebbels, and so on, were rabid atheists. Now, in the early 30s, Hitler wanted to win the support of the Catholic Church in Bavaria and the Lutheran churches in Germany, and so he invented a sort of Aryan Christ, a Christ, if you will, who would take his ultimate revenge on the Jews who killed him. But this was not successful. The churches repudiated him, and then it's well documented in a whole series of books by Evans and others that Hitler, once he came to power, set himself the clear goal of destroying the churches in Germany. So if you're saying, was the church a collaborator of Hitler? In general, no. As you point out, many Christians were strongly opposed to him, and the Nazi ideology itself was secular and racial.
Well, this is a very dignified and respectful cross-examination period. You're not giving me much to do. I think people are... See, they paid $10. They want to see a little Jerry Springer action here. Honestly, this is terrific. Thank you for giving us a real treat in that exchange. Well, if you took the time to fill out a card while our debaters take a moment to get a drink of water and cool down while we set up for Q&A from the audience, we'd be delighted to collect these. What I'd like you to do is to pass them down from the bleachers, just pass them over the shoulder of the person in front of you. Just pass them down. We'll have people at the bottom to collect them. If you're in the middle sections, pass them to the outside. Pass them to the outside. We'll take just a moment as the lights come on and collect the cards. Pass the cards down and out. All right, a few instructions as we get ready for Q&A from the audience. Hey, Bill, did you have a question? Did he have a question? I want to give him first shot. Did you want to ask a question? Okay. If you have a question for our speakers this evening, we have two mics here. If you have a question for Peter Singer, we'd like you to line up at this mic. If you have a question for Dinesh D'Souza, we'd like you to line up at this mic. Hopefully your questions have been peer-reviewed. Pass in your card. Thank you so much for passing those in. Everything okay? All right, we're going to start audience Q&A. We'd like to hear the first question for Dinesh D'Souza, which will come from this microphone. Y'all ready? You have a peer-reviewed question ready. Singer on that side. Are you prepared? Okay. Yeah, that's okay. Keep the questions brief, and you're going to ask one of Dinesh D'Souza. All right. Here we go, folks. First question for Dinesh D'Souza right here.
Good evening, Mr. Cooper.
Hello.
My name is Chris. If you believe in the designer of the universe, then the designer must be more complex than the universe. Should the designer have either matter or energy to design the universe? And if it does, should it be easily seen? If so, why don't we see it? Or do you think it is simply invisible or transcendent or even of another dimension?
Well, the argument I made is that material objects that have an origin, a beginning, require a cause. Now, that cause can be material or immaterial. But in the case of the universe, we can't posit a material cause because the universe encompasses all material reality. That is the definition of the universe. So the cause of a universe must necessarily be immaterial. It must be super powerful because obviously it was strong enough in some ways to create the universe. And so one can infer from the universe that we see in front of us some of the attributes. Omnipotence, for example. We don't know if it was omnipotence, but we know it was a great deal of power that it took to bring the universe into being. So what we are doing here is we're fallible human beings. We weren't there, we don't know. We are inferring to the best explanation. And what I'm saying is, it's a little bit like if you go into a cave and you see hieroglyphics. You may not know what those mean, but you can infer that someone did those. It's possible that chance assemblies of chemicals created those letters, but the more likely explanation is that somebody was there and made those paintings or did those drawings or did those letters, even if you can't fully decipher them. So that's really what I'm doing, is I'm using inference to what seems to be the most plausible explanation for this universe. It could be that there are many other universes, but we have absolutely no scientific or empirical basis for saying so. It is atheist guesswork to get around the idea of a creator.
Can I follow that up?
No. one minute response from Peter Singer, if you'd like.
Oh, I don't. No, I won't respond to that. I mean, okay. I think the questioner made the
Peter
point.
Peter, thanks again. Really helped me with some insights. Something that came up at a couple points in the debate was the notion of morality and caring. And at a number of times, I think you said that a human with higher intellect had the ability to empathize and be compassionate. And I'm wondering if, in fact, we live in a godless universe and we are products of a Darwinian process, what is the basis for compassion?
So if we live in a godless universe, what is the basis of compassion? Well, one could give two different answers to that, really, I think, and both are possible. One is simply that we have evolved to have compassion, that we are empathetic beings, perhaps because we're social beings, and we do better by actually caring for each other. So because of that, we emotionally do care, and I think there's a lot of psychological evidence about that. But we could also argue, and I think this is the answer to Dinesh's claim that there can be no objective morality without God, we could also argue that it's because we're capable of reasoning, that we're capable of seeing that the interests of others are like our own. So I know that I suffer, and I know that I hate it, for example, if I am lying there in pain, sick, unable to help myself. And then I see someone else, right? I'm obviously, you know, like the Good Samaritan here, if you like. I see someone else sick and in pain. So I think they must be suffering like I would. I would hate it if I were in that situation. And I can help them. I can give them some money. I've got plenty. I can take them to the inn or whatever it might be. And I can help them at little cost to myself. Why shouldn't I do that? I don't think you need to believe in God to take that view. I think you can simply take that view because we are rational beings capable of putting ourselves in the position of others.
May I offer a thought briefly? Yes. Number one, if we are rational beings, we might be able to see that the other person is suffering like we do, but it doesn't explain for one moment why we would care about that. That is the added ingredient that is being smuggled in here. Second point is there's a huge Darwinian scholarship on morality, and much of it basically says that morality is a form of disguised selfishness. So a mother who jumps into a burning car, for example, to save her two children, she might seem to be noble, but she's really doing it because those children share her genes. So the compassion, the fellow feeling, has a hidden genetic agenda. By saving the children, the genes make their way into the next generation. But this does not explain the main thrust of what Peter Singer has been saying, which is compassion for strangers. If I get up to give my seat in a bus to a woman who's 85 years old, It's not because I'm cunningly calculating that the next week I want her seat. I get nothing out of it. If you give blood, if you're a soldier willing to die for your country, these are acts of sacrifice and altruism that run against your selfish perpetuation of your genes. They have no good Darwinian explanation.
Thank you very much. A question for Dinesh D'Souza.
This might actually be a question for both of you. You both seem to use evidence to argue for your respective contrary views. And if that is the case, it seems to me that evidence is not neutral, but system-dependent or person-relative. And if that is the case, then evidence gains its meaning and intensity within a particular conceptual scheme. And if that is true, isn't one position just as good as the other?
Dinesh, you could start.
Well, the more I think about your question, in a sense, what you say is true, and by that I mean that both theism and atheism are metaphysical propositions. Either God exists or he doesn't. In some ways, I see Peter Singer's work as a working out of what really happens if God doesn't exist. And so, for example, although he's ducked the particular hard cases that he writes about tonight, essentially he says, this idea of the sacredness of human life, that's gotta go. And I think that if you remove the divine foundation, it's true. I mean, think about Jefferson, for example, in trying to posit where rights come from. Now, Jefferson was one of the least religious of the founders, and yet in trying to identify the source of rights, he could do no better than to appeal to the Creator. In a sense, what he's saying is that many of the rights that we value in Western civilization come from God. No God, no rights. Now, the philosopher Nietzsche thought, wonderful, let's get rid of the Christian idea of equality, let's get rid of these ideas of special dignity. Nietzsche hated the idea of compassion. So in some senses, what Peter Singer is trying to do, I think, is split the difference. He's taking the Christian values he doesn't like, for example, the idea that the unborn fetus has a right to life, or the 10-day-old fetus has a right to life, and he goes, let's get rid of that. He's keeping the Christian values he wants to retain. So, for example, he likes the idea of redistributing income to people who have less, so that Christian value survives his scheme. I'm suggesting it's a kind of inconsistent amalgam in which he's not following his atheism all the way through, but he's following it far enough to get rid of many of the core assumptions that if we got rid of them, we'd live in a much more nasty and brutish society.
Professor Singer, a one-minute response?
Yeah, I just say I don't understand how your answer, what you just said, Dinesh, is an answer to the question at all, but never mind. My answer to your question is no. I think your question suggests that there's a kind of relativism about truth, that we just have our own separate bodies of evidence, and I have mine and he has his, and there's no truth between them. Well, I think that's wrong. I think, let me say, one of the things, I've criticized many things that Dinesh has said, one of the things I admire about him is that he does argue. If you look at his book, it's full of arguments. And I think that's great. And actually, I have to say, I much prefer that to Christians who simply say, I'm not going to argue about God. I just know that God exists. I have faith that God exists, whatever it might be. I really think that's a cop-out. So I think what we have to do, and we've tried to do it now, but we, of course, could do it at much greater length and more fully, is sit down and look at these arguments, look at all of this evidence, and sort it through. And I believe that because, as I've been saying, we're rational beings, we could then get somewhere. Thank you.
Very good. Before you ask your question, I'm going to give away three prizes, two books by Singer and one by D'Souza. No, really, you were winners here. Leah Robertson of Compton book. You can pick these up in the back when you're done. Leah Robertson of Compton. It's okay, you can whoop if you win one. Carl Steves of Campbell. Book, Writings on an Ethical Life by Peter Singer, and Aaron Brubaker of San Diego, Animal Liberation is Yours. Those three will be waiting in the back, and I'll give away some more before our next question. Sir, your question for Peter Singer.
I've never been to an event like this, so it's been very interesting, and thank you all for having me. But it seems like... thank you for setting up such an event. It seems like that when all of the evidence points logically to the conclusion of a God, that you tend to come up with a different hypothesis. So what's confusing to me as watching you be the atheist viewpoint, it seems like rather than look at the evidence and just see where it leads, you start with the position that God doesn't exist and then see if the evidence can get you there. And then when it doesn't, you come up with a different hypothesis. And my question is simply, is that true what I feel like, or am I wrong?
I think you're wrong, if I've understood you correctly. I mean, I think I'm exactly looking at the evidence. I'm looking at the world around us. I'm seeing what a mess it is, what an awful place in many ways. All of these people who are poor and hungry and starving and all of the animal suffering that is going on. And I'm saying this is evidence against the existence of a God according to the Christian model. I think I'm exactly looking at the evidence. And I don't see the evidence that you refer to, you seem to be referring to, for the existence of this God. I just don't see any evidence that stands up to any critical examination.
Dinesh D'Souza, brief reply.
Look, ultimately here, let's take one more look at this issue of suffering, because in a sense it's being mounted, as Job did, as a complaint against God. And the argument would go something like this: God, why don't I have both my hands? Now the question you have to ask is, if it is the case that there is a God, and if there, it is the case that He created us, all living creatures have been given something to which they are not entitled in any way, namely life itself. Even the person who has little or who is suffering is often clinging to life, which is to say life is valuable to us. We're still in the plus column because we want to keep living. And so what I'm getting at is, do we really have a legitimate complaint against God by saying, in a sense, I've only got one hand, that guy has two. Why did you make me with one hand? Or why did you give me cancer so I have only 47 years of life when I could have had 70? Seems to me that these complaints ring hollow when you consider that our entire life and everything we have is in fact a gift from God. So on the premise that God exists, which was His premise, it looks to me that He has not done anything to any of us that has put us in the negative column. We still, in a sense, are on the positive side of the ledger because we still have something to which we have no claim and no right against Him, namely the gift of life itself.
Sorry, but I can't resist saying, on this argument, a baby who's damaged because her mother took cocaine during pregnancy has no complaints at all, too.
All right.
Because her mother gave her the gift of life. So she shouldn't complain because of the fact that she's damaged because the mother took cocaine. It's pretty much like the analogy Dinesh gave us.
Question for Dinesh D'Souza.
I was given the impression...
and loud, right into the microphone.
I was given an impression while you were debating Daniel Dennett at Tufts University that you're a macroevolutionist. Is this true?
The question is, am I a macroevolutionist? Well, I'm not a biologist. But I can say what I think about it, and that is, look, I think that in some ways, look, I don't have a problem with macroevolution. It seems to me that if the dachshund and the Saint Bernard, two species of dog, could have a common ancestor, it's possible that the dog and the wolf could have a common ancestor, even if they are separate and distinct species. But here's the point I want to make. It's not that I object to macroevolution, but what I object to is the fact that there are many people who take legitimate biological science and they smuggle atheist assumptions into it. There's a difference between evolution, which I don't have a problem with, and metaphysical Darwinism, which is atheism riding under the banner of science. So what often happens is you'll have a reasonable statement about the fossil record, and then someone will jump to this. And therefore, we conclude that Darwin has shown that you can have the appearance of design without a designer. Here I'm quoting Richard Dawkins. Or that this has rendered the possibility of a God superfluous. There's a lot in Peter Singer's own writing that's of this ilk. And it seems to me that it's an attempt to illegitimately use the moral prestige of science, which has a lot of prestige in our society, to ultimately push an atheist agenda.
No, actually, we're going to move on. Brief reply by Peter Singer.
Yes, I'm glad that Dinesh acknowledges that evolution is the best explanation of how we've come to be how we are. I don't agree that it necessarily, that there is a kind of this metaphysical atheism. I think that evolution does undermine one important argument for the existence of God, which people believed before we had evolution, and that is the argument from design, that things fit together in such a way that they had to be designed. Evolution shows that that's not true, and as Dinesh says in his book, it's amply supported by the fact that looking at all of the fossil record, we never find one of the earlier forms of life in a later strata of rocks. For example, we don't find humans with dinosaurs in the same strata of rocks. So it's amply supported, and it does undermine one of the traditional arguments for the existence of God. It's not incompatible with the existence of God, but it is incompatible perhaps with a literal understanding of the first of the opening of Genesis.
Before we go to the next question, two prizes. My book goes to Jonathan Bates, La Mirada, Jonathan Bates, La Mirada, and a subscription to Philosophia Christi, our journal, Robert Stevenson of Fullerton. Sir, your question.
I propose a scenario whereby all suffering is due to crimes committed in a prior life. In my scenario, that suffering is corrective in nature and therefore good and not bad. So how is it, in the absence of an objective moral standard against which you and I can measure our views, your view would be qualitatively superior to my view?
Well, if your suggestion is that you believe in reincarnation and that the reason that a kangaroo dies slowly of thirst in the drought is that in a prior life this kangaroo was Hitler or someone like that, I have to say, I just find this completely incredible. Well, I can't see any reason for believing that, and I don't even understand what it would be like to punish Hitler by making a kangaroo suffer in a drought.
Would you like to respond?
Well, I think the sort of flippancy of that answer shows that you're missing one of the great themes of all the great religions of the world, which is the belief in cosmic justice. In other words, we all live in a world where things are unfair. Often the bad guy ends up on top, the good guy comes to grief. And so we say that what goes around comes around, but we know it isn't always true. Now the point is that, in a sense, the great religions of the world say that even though life is unfair, there is a sort of ultimate fairness. There's cosmic justice. So reincarnation, whether you believe in it or not, and I don't believe in it, but nevertheless, it is addressing the issue of, do people in some ultimate sense get their just deserts? Christianity agrees with that and calls it the last judgment. So I think, in a sense, we are trying to speculate about something that is outside the bounds of human experience. And while you say that that's fanciful, he could just as easily turn around and say that for you to speculate on the intentions of God would be sort of like an ant speculating on why humans have created the cities that we have. Any answer is bound to be ridiculous.
I'll be waiting for you in the back. Sir, go right ahead. Question for Dinesh.
Mr. Dinesh, earlier you create a straw man fallacy that right and wrong needs to be an external idea, that humans can't possess this idea. Now, I would think, and I'd be curious how you would feel, that this alleviates the Christian from personal moral responsibility here on earth right now. That if divine judgment would alleviate responsibility here and now against other men.
Alas, the way you stated it seems like a non sequitur. Maybe I'm missing the force of your question. Obviously, our responsibilities are on earth. The point is simply that the bad stuff that we get away with will ultimately have to answer for. Why is that an abdication of our responsibility on earth? It means that if you do bad stuff in private, you're never spotted, you're never seen, that ultimately, in some sense, you're going to have... It is the ultimate statement of moral responsibility, because if you remove the idea of external accountability, then morality ultimately becomes entirely internal, entirely a human invention. You know, in Hamlet, you get the phrase, to thine own self be true. And for many of us, that is one way we try to access moral truths, but we want to think about it. I mean, is this advice you want to give Charles Manson? To thine own self be true? Is this something you'd want to say to Hitler? Follow your convictions, just do it. No. So this inner morality must be ultimately accountable to some external standard.
Comment, Dr. Singer?
I'm not totally sure that I understand where the question's coming from. I mean, I do think it just happens to be the case that we are here on Earth. We have to take responsibility for what we do. I don't see a plausible alternative. That, of course, doesn't mean that you just say, go with whatever you feel like, because, as I've been saying a few occasions, we do have the possibility of looking at the world in terms of looking at what we can do, putting ourselves in the position of others, trying to work out what's best for everyone when we do that, and that's the kind of accountability that I think we need to hold ourselves to in this world.
Two more questions. Some of you are bad at math and you're in line, and there's just no way we can get to you until 3 in the morning. Sir, a question for Peter Singer.
Dr. Singer, Souza offered you the Kalam cosmological argument in his opening statement, and you declined that. You said that the universe is eternal. If the universe is eternal, don't you have to deny the second law of thermodynamics?
No, I don't think that believing the universe is eternal means we have to deny the second law of thermodynamics, although it's possible, of course, that the second law of thermodynamics applies post-Big Bang only, and that there were other laws governing the universe that existed before the Big Bang. We simply don't know that. So, but we don't know what energy, in what way energy may change. There may be other laws that relate to that. So, I'm not a physicist. All I can tell you is that having discussed with physicists the possibility of an eternal universe, they certainly acknowledge that as a possibility.
The idea of the eternal universe was once the conventional wisdom of modern physics. In fact, it has a very ancient heritage. Aristotle believed, for example, the universe probably was eternal. But there have been important developments in the 20th century that have refuted and undermined this idea. Now look, 100 years from now we might know differently, but all debates have to be conducted with the state of knowledge as it exists today. I'm simply stating that he's misstating the mainstream of modern physics, which is that the universe is no longer held to be eternal, but is believed to have had a beginning. That is the whole concept behind the Big Bang. Now, some scientists who don't like this, many of them have openly said, and Stephen Hawking mentions this too, that they shirk from the supernatural implications of this possibility, are working very hard to disprove it and show that perhaps our universe was tunneled or wormholed from other existing universes. But these scientists confess that they have, in a sense, made up these other universes. These other universes have no empirical confirmation whatsoever. Stephen Hawking says there's no evidence for this, and there probably never will be. So all I'm saying is it takes as much, if not more, faith to believe in all these fictive, imaginary universes as it does to believe in one creative God.
One last question. We started with Dinesh. We'll end with Dinesh simply because it's his birthday, but let me give away a prize. One more seat in our lecture series coming up. That's for Ken Mason of La Mirada. Your prizes will be on the table in the back. Sir, the last question.
Dinesh, my question has to do with animal suffering in light of a benevolent God, and I was curious, as you never really answered Singer's question, animals that die cruel deaths because of humans or because of natural disasters, they never get repaid for that because there's no salvation within the Christian framework for animals, and they certainly don't get repaid for it on Earth. So why would God design animals with nervous systems and the ability to feel pain when they would not be repaid for it? It's just gratuitous suffering, and I see it as meaningless.
Happy birthday.
Well, your question in its complexity inspires in me the thought that it would have been nice, Craig, if you had cut off the questions before he got started. But anyway, look, In some senses, I think these questions take on for me a little bit of an air of unreality, and here's why. God has created the universe as he did. It is a universe, if you will, that operates according to physical laws. It is a universe that operates according to what we often call the laws of nature. Now, the laws of nature are, certainly from our point of view, very harsh. It is a nature that is seemingly indifferent to suffering. We have catastrophes, earthquakes, rivers dry up, and so on. The question we have, that we are trying to get at here, and I want to just emphasize how peculiar a question is could God have created a universe with other sets of laws? Or could God have created a universe with no laws at all? In fact, the Muslim thinker Al-Ghazali says the universe doesn't have laws. Everything happens because Allah jumps in and wills it at every given moment. This is not a belief that has been mainstream in Western civilization, but conceivably the universe could be that way. Every time, for example, a kangaroo is hungry, an invisible being shows up with a visible hose and squirts the kangaroo with water. God didn't apparently create that kind of universe. Now, does this prove that God didn't exist? No. It makes us, for example, wonder. Look, we are thrown into life, and many of our most fundamental questions are very difficult to answer either by atheism or by theism. Why are we here? How did we get here? Where are we going? These are, if you will, questions of a cosmic nature, and to attempt to force me to answer them, otherwise, ergo, God does not exist, is foolishness. We are both, Peter and I, fumbling in the dark with what we do know, trying to make best sense of the world as it is. Suffering, in some sense, is inexplicable, both for the theist and for the atheist. On the other hand, at least the theist has an answer to the problem of suffering, which is to say that our terrestrial life is short. Even if we could escape the suffering, we will still die. And that ultimately is the big end point we all face. So the question is there something beyond that? I think that if we look at the totality of our experience, the moral voice within us, the design of the universe out there, not just that we live on a lucky planet, we live in a lucky universe in which it is extremely odd that there is something instead of nothing, and in which there are human beings who can actually apprehend that universe.
Peter Singer response.
Yes. You said that neither the atheist nor the theist can explain suffering. The existence of suffering is not a problem for the atheist. It's just an unfortunate fact about the world. Maybe it's part of evolution, that evolution that beings evolved with capacities to feel pain because that helped them survive and reproduce. They could sense dangerous situations and move away from them. But, you know, unfortunately, that means that they suffer a lot unnecessarily in all sorts of cases where they slowly die. Evolution doesn't care about that because evolution is not a consciously directed process. And that's essentially why evil is a problem for the theist, but not for the atheist.
Very good questions. Thank you so much. We're going to move right into closing comments for each speaker. Professor Singer's first for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Well, I think we've had a very interesting and, I hope, enlightening exchange of views. Let me say, I think this is exactly what universities should be about open discussion and debate of fundamental issues, and I'm glad we're doing it. Thank you. Let me also mention one other argument about religion and theism, which I wanted to mention in my opening statement but ran out of time. It seems to me another powerful argument against any particular religion, including Christianity, including monotheism, is that if we look at the facts sociologically, we know that the probability of being a Christian, a believing Christian, is overwhelmingly greater if you were the child of Christian parents and or grew up in a Christian society. And had you been the child of Muslim parents growing up in Saudi Arabia, it's overwhelmingly likely that you would have been a Muslim. And we can say the same about other religions. This, I think, makes it more difficult to believe. Not impossible, but makes it more difficult to believe, to be confident of your belief in any particular religion. Because it seems that sociological factors have such a powerful influence rather than simply looking at the evidence and the argument and coming to the conclusion that one religion is true or the other. Let me just briefly run through a couple of other things that I don't think Dinesh has responded to at all. He hasn't responded to my criticisms of the God revealed through the Bible, either of the genocidal divinity of the Old Testament, say, for example, it's only one of several examples of Numbers 31. He hasn't responded to the question as to whether Jesus actually got it wrong about the Second Coming, or whether we have to interpret the Gospels so metaphorically that we can't really have any more sense of what their literal truth is. Let me also say that Dinesh has on many occasions, in fact, right from his opening statements about morality and what would happen if we were godless, through to his arguments about suffering, where he says, well, at least the theist can console the sufferer and say, well, this life is not the only thing that there is, and give them hope of eternal life after death and so on, that this is perhaps, again, an explanation for the prevalence of religion. An explanation because it offers us comfort in a universe that does perhaps appear to many people to be bleak, especially if you've been brought up with the belief that the universe has some kind of overarching purpose and we're going to live eternally and so on. It can seem bleak to say, no, there really is no overarching purpose to it, it just exists, and we are mortal. We're going to be on this earth for 10 or 20 or 50 or 70 or 80 or, if we're very lucky, 100 years, but that's really going to be it. That's all there is. After that, the body dies and consciousness does not survive. I can easily understand why people find it consoling to believe that that is not true, but that should not be a reason for you to believe it to be true. We can't just shape the universe in accordance with our wishes and desires. We can tell ourselves all sorts of fairy stories in that way. I think we have to look at the universe as it is. And although it may appear bleak, I think it's still a fascinating place, a place in which we can have our own purposes. There's no overarching purpose to its creation, but we can still feel we are here in the universe. There are many things we can do, things, of course, we can do things that we enjoy, but we can also find purpose in trying to reduce the amount of suffering that exists in the world, which, as I've said, both atheists and Christians do. And we can feel that if we have, by the time we die, by the time we reach the end of however many years it is, we have left the world a somewhat better place than it would have been if we'd not lived, then at least perhaps we can die with some sense of fulfillment and satisfaction because we have done that. And for me, I have to say, that's enough, and that's all that I can believe in. Thank you.
Morality is a form of disguised selfishness. So a mother who jumps into a burning car, for example, to save her two children, she might seem to be noble, but she's really doing it because those children share her genes. So the compassion, the fellow feeling, has a hidden genetic agenda. By saving the children, the genes make their way into the next generation. But this does not explain the main thrust of what Peter Singer has been saying, which is compassion for strangers. If I get up to give my seat in a bus to a woman who's 85 years old, it's not because I'm cunningly calculating that the next week I want her seat. I get nothing out of it. If you give blood, if you're a soldier willing to die for your country, these are acts of sacrifice and altruism that run against your selfish perpetuation of your genes. They have no good Darwinian explanation.
Thank you very much. A question for Dinesh D'Souza.
This might actually be a question for both of you. You both seem to use evidence to argue for your respective contrary views. And if that is the case, it seems to me that evidence is not neutral, but system-dependent or person-relative.
And if that is the case, then evidence gains its meaning and intensity within a particular conceptual scheme. And if that is true, is in one position just as good as the other?
Dinesh, you could start.
Well, the more I think about your question, in a sense, what you say is true, and by that I mean that both theism and atheism are metaphysical propositions. Either God exists or he doesn't. In some ways, I see Peter Singer's work as a working out of what really happens if God doesn't exist. And so, for example, although he's ducked the particular hard cases that he writes about tonight, essentially he says, this idea of the sacredness of human life, that's gotta go. And I think that if you remove the divine foundation, it's true. I mean, think about Jefferson, for example, in trying to posit where rights come from. Now, Jefferson was one of the least religious of the founders, and yet in trying to identify the source of rights, he could do no better than to appeal to the Creator. In a sense, what he's saying is that many of the rights that we value in Western civilization come from God. No God, no rights. Now, the philosopher Nietzsche thought, wonderful, let's get rid of the Christian idea of equality, let's get rid of these ideas of special dignity. Nietzsche hated the idea of compassion. So in some senses, what Peter Singer is trying to do, I think, is split the difference. He's taking the Christian values he doesn't like, for example, the idea that the unborn fetus has a right to life, or the 10-day-old fetus has a right to life, and he goes, let's get rid of that. He's keeping the Christian values he wants to retain. So, for example, he likes the idea of redistributing income to people who have less, so that Christian value survives his scheme. I'm suggesting it's a kind of inconsistent amalgam in which he's not following his atheism all the way through, but he's following it far enough to get rid of many of the core assumptions that if we got rid of them, we'd live in a much more nasty and brutish society.
Professor Singer, a one-minute response?
I don't understand how your answer, what you just said, Dinesh, is an answer to the question at all, but never mind. My answer to your question is no. I think your question suggests that there's a kind of relativism about truth, that we just have our own separate bodies of evidence, and I have mine and he has his, and there's no truth between them. Well, I think that's wrong. I think, let me say, one of the things, I've criticized many things that Dinesh has said, one of the things I admire about him is that he does argue. If you look at his book, it's full of arguments. And I think that's great. And actually, I have to say, I much prefer that to Christians who simply say, I'm not going to argue about God, I just know that God exists, I have faith that God exists, whatever it might be. I really think that that's a cop-out. So I think what we have to do, and we've tried to do it now, but we, of course, could do it at much greater length and more fully, is sit down and look at these arguments, look at all of this evidence, and sort it through. And I believe that because, as I've been saying, we're rational beings, we could then get somewhere. Thank you.
Very good. Before you ask your question, I'm going to give away three prizes, two books by Singer and one by D'Souza. No, really, you were winners here. Leah Robertson of Compton book. You can pick these up in the back when you're done. Leah Robertson of Compton. It's okay, you can whoop if you win one. Carl Steeves of Campbell. Carl Steeves of Campbell. Book, Writings on an Ethical Life by Peter Singer, and Aaron Brubaker of San Diego, Animal Liberation is Yours. Those three will be waiting in the back, and I'll give away some more before our next question. Sir, your question for Peter Singer.
I've never been to an event like this, so it's been very interesting, and thank you all for having me. But it seems like... thank you for setting up such an event. It seems like that when all of the evidence points logically to the conclusion of a God, that you tend to come up with a different hypothesis. So what's confusing to me as watching you be the atheist viewpoint, it seems like rather than look at the evidence and just see where it leads, you start with the position that God doesn't exist and then see if the evidence can get you there. And then when it doesn't, you come up with a different hypothesis. And my question is simply, Is that true, what I feel like, or am I wrong?
I think you're wrong, if I've understood you correctly. I mean, I think I'm exactly looking at the evidence. I'm looking at the world around us. I'm seeing what a mess it is, what an awful place in many ways. All of these people who are poor and hungry and starving, and all of the animal suffering that is going on. And I'm saying this is evidence against the existence of a God according to the Christian model. I think I'm exactly looking at the evidence. And I don't see the evidence that you refer to, you seem to be referring to, for the existence of this God. I just don't see any evidence that stands up to any critical examination.
Dinesh D'Souza, brief reply.
Look, ultimately here, let's take one more look at this issue of suffering, because in a sense it's being mounted, as Job did, as a complaint against God. And the argument would go something like this: God, why don't I have both my hands? Now the question you have to ask is, if it is the case that there is a God, and if there, it is the case that He created us, all living creatures have been given something to which they are not entitled in any way, namely life itself. Even the person who has little or who is suffering is often clinging to life, which is to say life is valuable to us. We're still in the plus column because we want to keep living. And so what I'm getting at is, do we really have a legitimate complaint against God by saying, in a sense, I've only got one hand, that guy has two. Why did you make me with one hand? Or why did you give me cancer so I have only 47 years of life when I could have had 70? Seems to me that these complaints ring hollow when you consider that our entire life and everything we have is in fact a gift from God. So on the premise that God exists, which was His premise, it looks to me that He has not done anything to any of us that has put us in the negative column. We still, in a sense, are on the positive side of the ledger because we still have something to which we have no claim and no right against Him, namely the gift of life itself.
Sorry, but I can't resist saying, on this argument, a baby who's damaged because her mother took cocaine during pregnancy has no complaints at all, too.
All right.
Because her mother gave her the gift of life. So she shouldn't complain because of the fact that she's damaged because the mother took cocaine. It's pretty much like the analogy Dinesh gave us.
Question for Dinesh D'Souza.
I was given the impression with your
nice debate, and loud, right into the microphone.
I was given an impression while you were debating Daniel Dennett at Tufts University that you're a macroevolutionist. Is this true?
The question is, am I a macroevolutionist? Well, I'm not a biologist. But I can say what I think about it, and that is, look, I think that in some ways, look, I don't have a problem with macroevolution. It seems to me that if the dachshund and the Saint Bernard, two species of dog, could have a common ancestor, it's possible that the dog and the wolf could have a common ancestor, even if they are separate and distinct species. But here's the point I want to make. It's not that I object to macroevolution, but what I object to is the fact that there are many people who take legitimate biological science and they smuggle atheist assumptions into it. There's a difference between evolution, which I don't have a problem with, and metaphysical Darwinism, which is atheism riding under the banner of science. So what often happens is you'll have a reasonable statement about the fossil record, and then someone will jump to this. And therefore, we conclude that Darwin has shown that you can have the appearance of design without a designer. Here I'm quoting Richard Dawkins. Or that this has rendered the possibility of a God superfluous. There's a lot in Peter Singer's own writing that's of this ilk. And it seems to me that it's an attempt to illegitimately use the moral prestige of science, which has a lot of prestige in our society, to ultimately push an atheist agenda.
No, actually, we're going to move on. Brief reply by Peter Singer.
Yes. I'm glad that Dinesh acknowledges that evolution is the best explanation of how we've come to be how we are. I don't agree that it necessarily, that there is a kind of this metaphysical atheism. I think that evolution does undermine one important argument for the existence of God, which people believed before we had evolution, and that is the argument from design, that things fit together in such a way that they had to be designed. Evolution shows that that's not true. And as Dinesh says in his book, It's amply supported by the fact that looking at all of the fossil record, we never find one of the earlier forms of life in a later strata of rocks. For example, we don't find humans with dinosaurs in the same strata of rocks. So it's amply supported, and it does undermine one of the traditional arguments for the existence of God. It's not incompatible with the existence of God, but it is incompatible perhaps with a literal understanding of the first of the opening of Genesis.
Before we go to the next question, two prizes. My book goes to Jonathan Bates, La Mirada. Jonathan Bates, La Mirada. And a subscription to Philosophia Christi, our journal, Robert Stevenson of Fullerton. Sir, your question.
I propose a scenario whereby all suffering is due to crimes committed in a prior life. In my scenario, that suffering is corrective in nature and therefore good and not bad. So how is it, in the absence of an objective moral standard against which you and I can measure our views, your view would be qualitatively superior to my view?
Well, if your suggestion is that you believe in reincarnation and that the reason that a kangaroo dies slowly of thirst in the drought is that in a prior life this kangaroo was Hitler or someone like that, I have to say I just find this completely incredible. Well, I can't see any reason for believing that, and I don't even understand what it would be like to punish Hitler by making a kangaroo suffer in a drought.
Would you like to respond?
Well, I think the sort of flippancy of that answer shows that you're missing one of the great themes of all the great religions of the world, which is the belief in cosmic justice. In other words, we all live in a world where things are unfair. Often the bad guy ends up on top, the good guy comes to grief. And so we say that what goes around comes around, but we know it isn't always true. Now the point is that, in a sense, the great religions of the world say that even though life is unfair, there is a sort of ultimate fairness. There's cosmic justice. So reincarnation, whether you believe in it or not, and I don't believe in it, but nevertheless, it is addressing the issue of, do people in some ultimate sense get their just desserts? Christianity agrees with that and calls it the last judgment. So I think, in a sense, we are trying to speculate about something that is outside the bounds of human experience. And while you say that that's fanciful, he could just as easily turn around and say that for you to speculate on the intentions of God would be sort of like an ant speculating on why humans have created the cities that we have. Any answer is bound to be ridiculous.
I'll be waiting for you in the back. Sir, go right ahead. Question for Dinesh.
Mr. Dinesh, earlier you create a straw man fallacy that right and wrong needs to be an external idea, that humans can't possess this idea. Now, I would think, and I'd be curious how you would feel, that this alleviates the Christian from personal moral responsibility here on Earth right now. That if divine, divine judgment would alleviate responsibility here and now against other men.
Alas, the way you stated it seems like a non sequitur. Maybe I'm missing the force of your question. Obviously, our responsibilities are on Earth. The point is simply that the bad stuff that we get away with will ultimately have to answer for. Why is that an abdication of our responsibility on Earth? It means that if you do bad stuff in private, you're never spotted, you're never seen, that ultimately, in some sense, you're going to have... It is the ultimate statement of moral responsibility, because if you remove the idea of external accountability, then morality ultimately becomes entirely internal, entirely a human invention. You know, in Hamlet, you get the phrase, "To thine own self be true." And for many of us, that is one way we try to access moral truths, but we want to think about it. I mean, is this advice you want to give Charles Manson? To thine own self be true? Is this something you'd want to say to Hitler? Follow your convictions, just do it? No. So this inner morality must be ultimately accountable to some external standard.
Comment, Dr. Singer?
I'm not totally sure that I understand where the question's coming from. I mean, I do think it just happens to be the case that we are here on Earth. We have to take responsibility for what we do. I don't see a plausible alternative. That, of course, doesn't mean that you just say, go with whatever you feel like. because, as I've been saying a few occasions, we do have the possibility of looking at the world in terms of looking at what we can do, putting ourselves in the position of others, trying to work out what's best for everyone when we do that, and that's the kind of accountability that I think we need to hold ourselves to in this world.
Two more questions. Some of you are bad at math and you're in line and there's just no way we can get to you until 3 a.m. Sir, a question for Peter Singer.
Dr. Singer, Souza offered you the Kalam cosmological argument in his opening statement and you declined that. You said that the universe is eternal. If the universe is eternal, don't you have to deny the second law of thermodynamics?
No, I don't think that believing the universe is eternal means we have to deny the second law of thermodynamics, although it's possible, of course, that the second law of thermodynamics applies post-Big Bang only, and that there were other laws governing the universe that existed before the Big Bang. We simply don't know that, but we don't know what energy...
I was trying to make is that animals are primarily responsible for the suffering of other animals, aren't they?
No.
In other words, no. You wouldn't say that, haven't you watched the Nature Channel?
Yeah, it's interesting that the Nature Channel does not go somewhere where there's a drought, parts of southeastern Australia at the moment, where I come from, for example, and have long lingering shots of kangaroos who are dying of thirst because the creeks have dried up. Doesn't make good television.
Well, look.
Happens, though.
You're talking about things being right and wrong, good and evil, and the point I was suggesting earlier is these concepts have no meaning in a Darwinian universe. This is the point I was getting at. The idea of objective good and objective evil presumes the existence of external morality, a standard by which you can confidently say, in the belief that all these people will agree with you, that there is such a thing as right and wrong. So even suffering, for all its mystery, seems to me in a certain way to be pointing to this unwavering standard, which is in a sense the product of God. In other words, the idea of an objective morality by which we judge. And here's another point I want to make. We see all this natural evil around us, and it seems to me that suffering is mainly not so much an intellectual problem as it is an emotional problem. If I lose my arm, it's not so much how did this happen, but rather how do I go on? If I lose a child, my biggest dilemma is what is the meaning of life? How can I keep living? It's ironic that for all the intellectual difficulties that one has in explaining suffering, when someone really suffers, a child has cancer, for example, or a mother loses a daughter, atheism has nothing to say to such a person except things happen. On the other hand, the Christian, the theist, can address suffering, make suffering perhaps meaningful, offer the suffering person hope. In that sense, it seems to me that theism and Christianity is offering something that people can really benefit from, some consolation, some expectation about the future. Meanwhile, the atheist, in a sense, has got to say nothing but, this is the way things are. Live with it.
Your question, I think.
Earlier, you, in talking about the universe, you offered some rather vague speculations. I mean, there's been 100 years of scientific progress that has coalesced around the idea of the Big Bang, the universe, if you will, having had that primordial moment, not just, by the way, the beginning of matter, but also, if you will, space and time coming into existence. Now, here's what I want to say, and that is, isn't it the case that you said you've talked to a guy who's done some work on this, and you said it is possible to imagine. Christians are often accused of what you could call the God of the gaps. When you can't explain something, God did it. Aren't you resorting to what could be called the atheism of the gaps, in which if you can't explain something, you basically say, we'll explain later, science is figuring it out. Go with the atheist assumption for now. In other words, to get rid of the simple explanation, God, you're basically waiting for atheism to kick in sometime in the future, aren't you?
I don't understand why it would be a simpler explanation to say that the world was created by a divine being who has existed forever than it would be to say that the universe has existed forever. Seems to me that to say the universe has existed forever is a simpler explanation. Now, your argument was that that the universe actually hasn't existed forever, that science says there was a Big Bang, and this in some way supports the creationist account of the universe. All I'm saying is that science doesn't say that. Science only says the observable universe began 13 point something billion years ago, and with a kind of a bang, and has been expanding since. That's all it says, and that's all it can say. So I'm simply saying there is no argument here to believe that your hypothesis, that it was created by a divine being, is in any better shape than the hypothesis that it has always existed.
Well, you just said that the observable universe is the universe we know. Are you saying that science can discern what occurs in unobservable universes?
Obviously not.
Exactly. So in other words, what I'm saying is, in order to avoid the implication of God, in order to abolish one unobservable God, you're inventing one or multiple unobservable universes, aren't you?
I'm not inventing it. I'm saying that it's a possibility that existed, just as it's a possibility that the God that you believe has existed. I'm simply saying there's no extra points for you on this side.
Well, your turn.
My question? Okay. Let me just say something about your claims about the crimes committed by atheists. I certainly agree, terrible crimes have been committed by atheists. You'll get no argument from me there. But I think terrible crimes have been committed by theists as well. We are aware of some very recent crimes committed by theists, Islamic rather than Christian theists. But that's certainly the result of strong religious faith, and I think it shows the dangers of strong religious faith in terms of what it can lead people to do. If we're adding up the numbers, the Inquisition may not have been big numbers. I think there are larger numbers that Christians have been responsible for destroying and enslaving. If you look at, for example, the Christians who conquered Mexico and Peru and the brutalities that they carried out and the ways they... this is not my time, I take it. This is our time that's up, isn't it? I'll just finish this question, and if we get... I think Dinesh should have a chance to answer. Right, okay, good. I think there are other large numbers of atrocities they've committed, and of course Christians have supported slavery historically. But let me just say one thing briefly then about the Nazis. Isn't it true that the German soldiers who went to advance the Nazi cause and the Nazi army wore belt buckles which said, engraved on them, Gott mit uns, God with us? Is this really compatible with the idea that Nazism was an atheist regime? And isn't it also true that the Nazis were cheered on, in many cases, by Christians? My parents were living in Vienna in 1938 when the Nazis invaded, and they were Jewish. And they remember that the Archbishop of Austria, Cardinal Innitzer, rang the church bells in celebration when the Nazis walked in. And when Hitler declared a referendum, of course not a free referendum, on the Anschluss, on the union of Austria and Germany, Cardinal Innitzer said, vote yes. So I think Christians bear a heavy responsibility, whether or not Hitler personally was a Christian. Maybe he wasn't. Maybe he was some kind of vague atheist. But I don't actually think he was an atheist, and I certainly think that Christians played a prominent role in the atrocities the Nazis committed. Although it's also true that some Christians heroically defied the Nazis and paid for it with their lives, as did some atheists.
Well, first of all, you says maybe, but Hitler, there's a book, Hitler's Table Talk, which is a rather extensive compilation of Hitler's actual views as compiled by his close advisors. It's very clear, emphatically, that he hated Christianity. And in a sense, what he was trying to do is replace, if you will, traditional Christian society with a new race utopia. The leading figures around Hitler, Himmler, Goebbels, and so on, were rabid atheists. Now, in the early 30s, Hitler wanted to win the support of the Catholic Church in Bavaria and the Lutheran churches in Germany, and so he invented a sort of Aryan Christ, a Christ, if you will, who would take his ultimate revenge on the Jews who killed him. But this was not successful. The churches repudiated him, and then it's well documented in a whole series of books by Evans and others that Hitler, once he came to power, set himself the clear goal of destroying the churches in Germany. So if you're saying, was the church a collaborator of Hitler? In general, no. As you point out, many Christians were strongly opposed to him, and the Nazi ideology itself was secular and racial.
Well, this is a very dignified and respectful cross-examination period. You're not giving me much to do. I think people are... See, they paid 10 bucks. They want to see a little Jerry Springer action here. Honestly, this is terrific. Thank you for giving us a real treat in that that exchange. Well, if you took the time to fill out a card while our debaters take a moment to get a drink of water and cool down while we set up for Q&A from the audience, we'd be delighted to collect these. What I'd like you to do is to pass them down from the bleachers, just pass them over the shoulder of the person in front of you. Just pass them down. We'll have people at the bottom to collect them. If you're in the middle sections, pass them to the outside. Pass them to the outside. We'll take just a moment as the lights come on and collect the cards. Pass the cards down and out. All right, a few instructions as we get ready for Q&A from the audience. Hey, Bill, did you have a question? Did he have a question? I want to give him first shot. Did you want to ask a question? Okay. If you have a question for our speakers this evening, we have two mics here. If you have a question for Peter Singer, we'd like you to line up at this mic. If you have a question for Dinesh D'Souza, we'd like you to line up at this mic. Hopefully your questions have been peer-reviewed. Pass in your card. Thank you so much for passing those in. Everything okay? All right, we're going to start audience Q&A. We'd like to hear the first question for Dinesh D'Souza, which will come from this microphone. Y'all ready? You have a peer-reviewed question ready. Singer on that side. Are you prepared? Okay. Yeah, that's okay. Keep the questions brief, and you're going to ask one of Dinesh D'Souza. All right. Here we go, folks. First question for Dinesh D'Souza right here.
Hello.
If you believe in the designer of the universe, then the designer must be more complex than the universe. Shouldn't the designer have either matter or energy to design the universe? And if it does, shouldn't it be easily seen? If so, why don't we see it? Or do you think it is simply invisible or transcendent or even of another dimension?
Well, the argument I made is that material objects that have an origin, a beginning, require a cause. Now, that cause can be material or immaterial. But in the case of the universe, we can't posit a material cause because the universe encompasses all material reality. That is the definition of the universe. So the cause of a universe must necessarily be immaterial. It must be super powerful because obviously it was strong enough in some ways to create the universe. And so one can infer from the universe that we see in front of us some of the attributes, omnipotence, for example. We don't know if it was omnipotence, but we know it was a great deal of power that it took to bring the universe into being. So what we are doing here is we're fallible human beings. We weren't there, we don't know. We are inferring to the best explanation. And what I'm saying is, it's a little bit like if you go into a cave and you see hieroglyphics. You may not know what those mean, but you can infer that someone did those. It's possible that chance assemblies of chemicals created those letters, but the more likely explanation is that somebody was there and made those paintings, or did those drawings, or did those letters, even if you can't fully decipher them. So that's really what I'm doing, is I'm using inference to what seems to be the most plausible explanation for this universe. It could be that there are many other universes, but we have absolutely no scientific or empirical basis for saying so. It is atheist guesswork to get around the idea of a creator.
one minute response from Peter Singer, if you'd like.
Oh, I don't. No, I won't respond to that. I mean, right. I think the questioner made the point.
Peter, thanks again. Really helped me with some insights. Something that came up at a couple points in the debate was the notion of morality and caring. And at a number of times, I think you said that a human with higher intellect had the ability to empathize and be compassionate. And I'm wondering if, in fact, we live in a godless universe and we are products of a Darwinian process, what is the basis for compassion?
So if we live in a godless universe, what is the basis of compassion? Well, one could give two different answers to that, really, I think, and both are possible. One is simply that we have evolved to have compassion, that we are empathetic beings, perhaps because we're social beings, and we do better by actually caring for each other. So because of that, we emotionally do care, and I think there's a lot of psychological evidence about that. But we could also argue, and I think this is the answer to Dinesh's claim that there can be no objective morality without God, we could also argue that it's because we're capable of reasoning, that we're capable of seeing that the interests of others are like our own. So I know that I suffer, and I know that I hate it, for example, if I am lying there in pain, sick, unable to help myself. And then I see someone else, right? I'm obviously, you know, like the Good Samaritan here, if you like. I see someone else sick and in pain, so I think they must be suffering like I would. I would hate it if I were in that situation, and I can help them. I can give them some money, I've got plenty. I can take them to the inn or whatever it might be, and I can help them at little cost to myself. Why shouldn't I do that? I don't think you need to believe in God to take that view. I think you can simply take that view because we are rational beings capable of putting ourselves in the position of others.
May I offer a thought briefly? Yes. Number one, if we are rational beings, we might be able to see that the other person is suffering like we do, but it doesn't explain for one moment why we would care about that. That is the added ingredient that is being smuggled in here. Second point is, there's a huge Darwinian scholarship on morality, and much of it basically says that morality...
This is a very old argument, of course. I'm not saying anything at all novel. You all know it. You're probably all familiar with it. Despite the fact that it's an old argument, generally Christians have not had very satisfactory responses. And I think, in fact, that Dinesh also, in his book, What's So Great About Christianity, does not say anything very much about it. He has a very few pages on this topic at all, and really only gets to the tough problem in a paragraph or two, which, not surprisingly, is not satisfactory. What do Christians usually say about it? Well, the most common response, I suppose, is to say, yes, there is suffering in the world, but there is suffering, and Dinesh, in fact, listed a lot of this suffering and the crimes of the atheists that he talked about, some of whom maybe were not actually all atheists, but anyway, talked about the things that people have done. And so most Christians say, well, God gave us free will. Free will is somehow seen as a great gift, as something that is essential. and indeed the importance of which in some way overrides all the suffering that Dinesh mentioned, and indeed all the suffering that humans have created in the world. Now, I think we might question whether giving humans free will is worth it, given what many of them have done with their free will. But let's just leave that. Let's just accept that claim, if you like. Let's just accept that somehow it was so important that we should have free will, that God could give us free will knowing in advance that the Nazis would murder 6 million innocent people, that Stalin would murder 20 million innocent people, that Pol Pot would murder 20% of the population of his country, and so on and so forth. Let's assume that God nevertheless did that. It is still the case that there is a lot of suffering in the world that is not explained by this, because there is a lot of suffering in the world that is nothing to do with anyone's free will. We all know that, we've all seen it. We've all seen natural disasters, earthquakes, floods, tsunamis, droughts, diseases, which strike people down, cause them to suffer, cause them to die, sometimes horrible, agonizing deaths, drawn-out deaths, or cause them to live in unspeakable afflictions, agony, constantly hungry or thirsty because of a drought, perhaps, that has caused crops to fail. And we can't explain that in terms of free will. It has nothing to do with free will. Nor can we explain it in terms of saying that we are fallen, as Christians tend to say, and therefore none of us are innocent. Because even if you believe that, and let me say, I think it would be a totally monstrous doctrine to believe that God would create a world in which, let's say, a 2-year-old child would die a slow and lingering death from hunger and thirst because that baby's alleged ancestors Adam and Eve, sinned. Again, I would think that would be a monstrous God who could make a baby suffer for that reason. But even if you still think that, even if you still think that the suffering of that baby is somehow deserved because of original sin, what about the suffering of non-human animals? They also die slow, miserable deaths through droughts or hunger or disease or a variety of other causes. And not even Christians believe that they suffer from original sin. They're not descended from Adam. And that suffering has been going on even longer than human suffering, because they've been sentient beings, sentient animals, for even longer. I think it's inexplicable on the Christian account of the world that animals should suffer in those ways. And I have to say, I could not possibly worship, I could not possibly revere a God who did that. If somehow it were proved to me that there is such a God, an all-powerful God, my attitude would have to be one of contempt and defiance, whatever it cost me. I think I would not have any integrity if I worshipped such a God simply because he was all-powerful when he was such a monster. Now again, of course, some Christians have been aware of all of this that I'm saying. What do they say? Well, actually, the only answer that seems to me even remotely to really answer the question was given by René Descartes, the 17th century French philosopher, who said, well, this is a big problem. This is a terrible problem, animal suffering, for belief in Christianity, but I have the answer. I can solve this problem which no one else can solve. And you know what his answer was? His answer was, animals don't suffer. They're just machines. He said, look, your clock makes a noise, but that doesn't mean it's conscious. It's just a machine. Animals are machines made by God. A bit more complicated, of course, because God made them, not just us. So the noises they make, the fact that they cry out or yelp or whine when they're hurt, doesn't mean that they suffer. They're just complicated machines. Well, if you can believe that, okay, you can get away from the problem of evil. But I don't think many people who live with a dog or a cat or know anything about animals could possibly believe that. And I don't think there's any other plausible solution to the problem of evil. Okay, let me just say a few more things in the time that I have remaining. If somehow I were to come to believe in God, I could still not possibly think that the account of Jesus as given by the Gospels is an account of a being who I would want to regard as part of God or the Son of God or whatever particular view of the Trinity you may hold. It seems to me clear that the Gospels present an image of a person who, firstly, was mistaken about the future, deeply mistaken about the second coming. It must be evident, I think, to anyone who reads the Gospels and takes them at all in their obvious face value meaning, that Jesus believed the second coming would occur in the lifetime of those, or some of those, to whom he was speaking. He says it on several occasions. You can find it in Mark and Matthew. I'm sure many of you will know the verses better than I do. That some of you here will not have tasted death before the coming. It didn't happen. Take it, that's not news to any of you. It didn't happen. Paul also said something similar, clearly expected it to happen. It didn't happen. Christians have been saying it ever since. It didn't happen. Christians are still saying it. They're constantly setting new dates for when it's going to happen. It doesn't happen. Well, I'm not focusing on the current Christians, but Jesus clearly was mistaken about that. And if you want to take the gospel seriously, then I think you have to admit he was wrong. Of course, you could have some figurative interpretation of it. He didn't mean it literally. But once you do that, anything goes. Once you have those kind of metaphorical interpretations of the Gospels, we can all argue about the messages of the Gospels in a variety of different ways. Let me also say that I think the image of God given in the Old Testament is, if anything, considerably worse. The God in the Old Testament seems to quite openly embrace exactly the crimes that Dinesh accused atheists of carrying out, namely genocide. Have a look at Numbers 31, if you don't believe me. It's not something that's probably read regularly in church. But God tells Moses to strike against the Midianites, people whose women have been sleeping with some Israelites and have led them to worship the Midianite god. So the Israelites arm themselves, they go out, they attack the Midianites, they kill all the Midianite men, they carry off their cattle, they burn their villages, and then they bring the women and children back in front of Moses. And Moses, who's been instructed by God on what he should do, gets angry with them and says, "What? Did you spare the women? They're the ones who induced our Israelites to worship the false gods. So kill all the women who have known men," all the non-virgins, in other words. "Kill them all. And kill all the male children. Slaughter all the male children," who are completely innocent, obviously, small children. "The only ones you don't slaughter are the virgins. Them take for yourselves." That's what God instructs the Israelites to do. Can we seriously worship such a God if we believe in him? I think it's better to regard this as a kind of a myth, a fairy tale, a national story is made up by a warring primitive tribe than the revealed word of God. So now let me just say I'll make one point in response to what Dinesh said about morality, and I'll perhaps come back to it in a later rebuttal. Dinesh said that compassion came into the world because of Christianity. He's historically wrong. If you know anything at all about Buddhism, you will know that compassion is a basic principle. Compassion not only for humans, incidentally, but for all sentient beings, is a first principle of Buddhism. And if you know your history, you know that Buddhism existed about 500 years before Jesus. So compassion didn't come into the world because of Christianity. Christianity may have spread it in certain areas where Buddhism didn't. I'm not going to say that Christianity has been bad in every respect. It certainly hasn't. But we can certainly have compassionate atheists because, in fact, Buddhists don't believe in God. They are atheists in the strict sense of the term. And yet, compassion is very important for them, and I would defy anyone to say that, in general, Christians are more compassionate than Buddhists are, though I'm not a Buddhist. I don't carry any particular baggage for Buddhism, but it's simply a fact on the record. It's also interesting that despite the alleged moral virtues of Christianity, the United States does not seem to be a more virtuous nation than the more secular nations of Europe or Australia. Okay, just to finish my sentence. If you look, for example, the Times had an article just last week. The prison population of the United States. The United States has 5% of the world's population. It has 25% of the world's prisoners, inmates. I'll rest with that.
Thank you very much. Each debater will have a 5-minute rebuttal. Dinesh.
Well, on the issue of Buddhism, if there's a famine tomorrow in Rwanda, you'll notice something very interesting, which is to say the Western nations will rush to help, send volunteers, the churches will send food, Doctors Without Borders, there'll be people writing checks. You'll notice that in the other cultures of the world, there's a relative indifference, including cultures that have been influenced by Buddhism. Buddhism, of course, rejected in the land of its birth, India, and for many centuries having a very thin imprint on the world. So compassion as a practical matter embedded itself in Western civilization. There was an idea of it in Buddhism, but it was not really taken up by anyone. Now, with regard to the business about, the evidence of God, I don't want this to be a debate of two ships passing in the night, so I'm gonna offer a couple of quick arguments because I then want to address Peter Singer's specific claims about suffering. We know we live in a universe that had a beginning. Now, everything that has a beginning, every material thing that has a beginning, has a cause. What is the cause of the universe? What is the cause for which the universe is an effect? You might say, could it be a natural cause? No, because the universe encompasses all that is natural. If something caused the universe, it would have to be something non-natural or, to put it somewhat differently, supernatural. This would be my first argument for the existence of a designer. Second, a universe is, you may say, fine-tuned for life. And what I mean by this is that our universe, not just our planet, but our entire universe has to be as old as it is and as big as it is and have the precise numerical values it does, the electromagnetic force, the gravitational force, the strong nuclear force, the so-called electroweak force. Stephen Hawking, in his book A Brief History of Time, says that if you touch one of those numerical dials, he's talking about the rate of expansion of the universe, and you move it, not 10%, not 1%, one part in 100,000 million million, you would have no universe. You would have no life. Our entire universe appears to be a kind of conspiracy to produce, you might say, us, beings that can contemplate such a universe. This argument has put atheism on the complete defensive. There is no alternative explanation of such a fine-tuned universe that makes more sense than to posit an intelligent creator. Finally, morality. What's interesting is that we are supposed to be Darwinian primates, and yet we have within us this unshakable conviction that we should frequently act against our self-interest. I'm walking in the riverbank. I hear someone shout, help, help, help. I'm not a very good swimmer. If I want to perpetuate my genes, I'll keep walking. That's not my wife or my daughter. That guy is no one to me. And yet if I keep walking, a little voice in my head says, no, you really should try to help him, but I can't swim that well. This voice that we can't avoid, we all have it. In fact, if we don't have it, we're sociopaths or psychopaths. The person who has no morality, no conception of it. And this morality frequently militates against self-interest. It has no Darwinian explanation. Where does this objective morality come from? Where does the moral law derive from, if not from a moral lawgiver? Now, I want to say a couple of things about suffering. I won't be able to do full justice to it in the time I have, but I'm happy to come back to it. The first point I want to make is that the atheists love to throw the argument about suffering as if they invented it. Actually, they got it out of the book of Job. This is an argument that Christians are not only familiar with, but have thought harder about than the sort of glib assertions of, well, what happens to the guy who was born with one arm, or the child with cancer, and so on. In Job's case, a tremendous reversal.
The first opening statement will be Dinesh D'Souza for 15 minutes. You ready? Very good.
I am delighted and honored to be here. I'm looking forward to a lively debate. In fact, thinking about this and thinking about our election season, I was remembering back to 1984. You might remember some of the, some of you won't remember, the Reagan-Mondale debates. There wasn't much of a debate, really. Reagan would speak and Mondale would make accusations and Reagan would ignore him. Finally, one of the reporters, Andrea Mitchell, said, President Reagan, what do you think of Mondale's charges? And Reagan said, I think he should pay them. Walks off. Well, we sometimes have special occasions and weeks, Black History Month and so on. For me, this has been something I like to call Atheist Bashing Week, because I've actually been doing several debates this week, but it's culminating in this one. And I want to welcome Peter Singer, because in some ways I think that in making this case, he represents the sharpest, perhaps in some ways the deepest, certainly the most lucid, and in a very profound way the most consistent in arguing out the premises and the implications of atheism. Peter Singer is a controversial figure, and it's not entirely surprising. He has advanced theses that have caused a little bit of shock. He has argued, for example, that not only should abortion be permitted to the moment of pregnancy, but people should be able to kill their infants up to the age of 28 days, essentially without restriction. He has also argued that other cultures kill their children at much further ages, 1 year, 2 years, 5 years old. He says we can actually learn from these cultures with a view to perhaps adopting some of their practices. He's also argued in favor of euthanasia, which is the killing of people who are old and in a sense have ceased to get very much out of life, perhaps. And then somewhat paradoxically, he is also a champion of animal rights. In fact, he has argued that even the fish and the rats may have more consciousness, more awareness of their surroundings, and in some senses have a better claim to life than handicapped humans who don't have that kind of awareness. Now, when he argues these things, people usually get horrified and they gasp and they say, how can you think this? So they think he's kidding. But I want to suggest, actually, that we should calm down and take a hard look at what he's saying, because really, I think what he's trying to show us is the logical implications of a purely secular society. Now, what I mean by this is that we all think we know what a secular society looks like. We have, in a sense, one foot in secular society. Europe is, we think, a secular society, but no. Our society, and certainly Western civilization, remains imbued, in some ways drenched, with Christian assumptions. Even people who think they are acting in secular ways are often reflecting those assumptions. We need to think hard of what it would be like in a society where you have completely removed God from the picture. Now, this is what I take to be Peter Singer's argument, and I'm stating it not completely to disagree with it. I'm going to comment on it after I state it. I think he's saying, in a sense, that if God is dead, and he thinks God is dead, then Christian morality is based on a myth. And so having killed God, it's not enough to stop there. You've got to work it through and get rid of all the Christian morality that comes out of that Christian God. So, for example, the idea that we've long had in the West of the preciousness and equal dignity of human life, he thinks that needs to go. The specialness of human life, human beings in a sense differentiated in some ways, having rights, for example, that are not extended to other living creatures. This idea of life as unique, human life as special, he thinks that we should get rid of that one. The prohibition against the deliberate killing of the innocents. This has been a bedrock principle of Western civilization. It is an emanation of Christianity. He would like us to move beyond it. In some senses, what Peter Singer is saying is that either we are the special creation of God, or we are Darwinian primates. Since we are Darwinian primates, we've got to recognize that Christianity is a myth. Christianity came into the world, and it took human beings, and it put them on this pedestal. It said, God loves you. God, in a sense, created everything because of you. You have special dignity, special worth, special rights. And in a sense, Singer is saying, now we've got to move away from all that. We've got to knock man off his pedestal and bring him down. And also, automatically, the position of the animals moves up. So one may say the Darwinian natural continuum is thereby restored. Now, if all of this seems a little bizarre, I actually want to suggest that I agree completely with this argument. If the premise is true, the conclusions do indeed follow. Now, other leading atheists, people like Christopher Hitchens, Richard Dawkins, and others, I've been debating some of them, and they often say, listen, we can be good without God. We can preserve Christian morality without the Christian God. We can retain compassion. We can retain the value of human life. We can retain the equal dignity of women. We can just get rid of, if you will, the divine foundation. Richard Dawkins has even called himself a cultural Christian. I take Peter Singer to be arguing that this view is a complete illusion. And in this sense, I'm on Peter Singer's side of the debate. I want to say very briefly why. One way we can look at the distinctive heritage of Christianity is you just have to look to ancient Greece and Rome. I'm talking about pre-Christian Rome, before Christianity. First of all, the ancient Spartans, very famously, if the child was sick or unwanted or feeble, they would leave it on the hillside and be quite happy to find it dead in the morning. This is not actually so shocking. What is shocking is the great thinkers of ancient Greece, Plato, Aristotle, knew about this and viewed it with relative equanimity. Now, why? That's because the idea of the worth or sacredness of human life, this was simply not a big value in ancient Greece and Rome. Infanticide was, in fact, quite common in those societies. Slavery was very common in ancient Greece and Rome. And some people say, well, didn't it continue under Christianity? Well, not really. In fact, between the 3rd and the 10th centuries, slavery was eradicated from most of Europe. And then later, you had strong anti-slavery or abolition movements largely motivated by Christianity. The Quakers, the evangelical Christians, basically said if we are created equal in the eyes of God, a theological point, then no man has the right to rule another man without his consent. And this idea became the basis not only of anti-slavery or abolition, it also became the basis of democracy, which is based on the very same principle. No man has the right to rule another without consent. Or look at the idea of compassion. Aristotle makes a list of the virtues. Compassion does not appear on that list. In some ways, Aristotle saw it more as a vice. So compassion is a value that came into the world because of Christianity. In a sense, I take Peter Singer to be arguing that we need not so much to go forward as to go back to that kind of a pre-Christian world in which life is valued not so much for itself as an end in itself, but as a means. as a means, if you will, to Darwinian primates trying to make their way in the world. Now, I said earlier that we think we know about secular society, but in fact, historically, there have been very few secular societies, if any. But we have had great experiments in secularism in the last century, in the 20th century, where for the first time, you had thinkers and leaders who tried to implement, you might say, secular utopia. Yes, I'm thinking, for example, of Mao in China. I'm thinking of Stalin in Russia. I'm thinking of the Nazi regime in Germany, but not just those three. I'm thinking of Pol Pot in Indochina, Enver Hoxha, Kim Jong-il, Fidel Castro. Numerous experiments to do what? In a sense, to create a new man and a new utopia liberated from the shackles of traditional religion and traditional morality. Now, some people like to say, well, what about the crimes of religion? But quite interestingly, the crimes of religion, even the crimes of radical Islam, are infinitesimal when compared to the crimes, one may say, of trying to create the atheist secular society. The Inquisition, for example, over a period of 350 years, managed to kill some 2,000 people. Pol Pot, in the space of 3 years, and he doesn't even make it into the top tier of atheists, he killed about 3 million people in the space of just a few years. Altogether, the atheist regimes have killed well in excess of 100 million people. So they have spilled an ocean of blood and a mountain of bodies, all done, we may say, to create this secular utopia. Now, my conclusion is that it is atheism and not religion that is really responsible for the mass murders of history. Now, Peter Singer, I think, will rightly say, listen, don't equate me with the Nazis, don't equate me with the communists, I'm not proposing the kind of stuff they did. And in a sense, he is quite right. The Nazi regime, the communists, this was state-sponsored murder. This was killing by the state. Peter Singer doesn't want killing by the state. He wants killing by the individual. In other words, he doesn't want the government to kill people. He wants you and me and him to make those decisions for ourselves. Against the communist and fascist alternative, you might say, of totalitarian genocide, he offers a very interesting democratic alternative, free market homicide. Now, Dostoevsky, a long time ago, said in the Brothers Karamazov, if God is not, everything is permitted. I think what Dostoevsky meant by this is two things. One is, if you remove the idea of God from the world, there's no ultimate accountability. If you remove the idea of God from the world, there's no last judgment. There's not even the Hindu reincarnation in which you say to someone, you behave badly in this life, well, I guess we'll see you as a cockroach in the next one. If you remove the idea of God, you can get away with it if you aren't caught. And moreover, if you remove the idea of God, the other human being ceases to be God's creation, ceases to be in some way special, becomes, if you will, a means to our end. The philosopher Nietzsche contemplated this situation, and he made the following thought. He said, listen, there are many people in our society who want to eradicate God, but if you will keep the other principles of Western civilization, the principle of abolition, the principle of the equal dignity of women, the principle of compassion, the value of human life, Nietzsche felt it was an illusion. It's not going to happen. It'll take a little time, but ultimately those values will erode, and we're going to see terrible massacres in their wake. We have seen those massacres. We don't have to theorize about them. They've already happened. In some ways, I think what Peter Singer is projecting is what a democratic society, what a free society would look if it adopted these atheist principles and applied them to our own given situation. I want to suggest that we should think carefully. We better think not just twice, but three times and maybe four before we go down that blood-stained road. If God is not, everything is indeed permitted. Thank you very much.
Peter Singer, 15 minutes.
Thank you very much. I'm not going to start by responding to the things that Dinesh D'Souza has said, because my understanding is that we're here to debate the existence of God, not the details of my ethical views. I'm very happy to defend them and perhaps correct some of the misinterpretations or false impressions that you might have received from what Dinesh D'Souza has said, but that's not the subject of our debate. Let's talk about whether we ought to believe God exists. That's surely the starting point. Even if you think that the consequences of atheism are not going to be good, Dinesh D'Souza obviously does, I don't, as I will say a little bit more about later, still, you surely ought to be interested in the basic question, does God exist or not? And we haven't really heard any argument in the 15 minutes opening statement for that, except that if we don't believe it, the consequence is going to be bad. But, you know, sometimes things are true, even though we don't like the consequences of them. We all know that. If a doctor tells someone you love, perhaps even yourself, that you have cancer and will probably only have 6 months to live, you don't say, oh, that would be terrible, I would hate that, so it can't be true. You need to look at the evidence as to whether that is true or not. That's what I want to do. Now, when we're talking about God, of course, that concept can mean a lot of different things to a lot of different people. Since this is a Christian institution, since I know that Dinesh D'Souza is a Christian, and since we are living in a society that is Christian in its culture, I'm essentially going to talk about the Christian or the Judeo-Christian conception of God. And that's the being that I think I can claim does not exist. There may be other things in the universe people can talk about, you know, some vague life force or whatever, which it's much more difficult to prove or disprove it's the existence of such a being. But of the Christian, the Judeo-Christian God, I think we can be clear that that being does not exist, and the reason we can be clear about that is by looking at the world around us. The world around us contains an immensity of suffering. As far as we know, it always has contained, as long as there have been sentient beings, which goes back many millions of years, an immensity of suffering. Can we really believe that a God who is described as all-powerful, all-knowing, and all-good has created such a world? I think this is the major stumbling block to belief in the Christian God. It's always been, for me, the thing that has made it impossible for me to believe in such a God. A God who deliberately and knowingly created a world like this one could not be a good being. We might say either this kind of God was evil or this God was a bungler. There are no other options. But Christians, of course, deny either of those alternatives.
Now, this is a fortune's a very sophisticated argument. Call it imaginative, if you will. Nevertheless, its intellectual content substantial. But, so that's the first point. We've thought about it. Second, hidden in Peter Singer's articulation of this argument is a Christian assumption. Because if you think about it, his whole argument was based upon caring. He essentially said, what about the child who gets cancer? What about the animal who suffers? The first question to ask is, if we are Darwinian primates, who cares? Why on earth would a dog care if a cat gets bitten? Why on earth would we, if our goal in life is to perpetuate our genes and promote our own self-interest, we would be relatively indifferent, particularly to the sufferings of strangers? Of course, if it's our relatives, you could say we share their genes. So I want to suggest that this presumption that we care is itself a legacy of theism, because it presumes that the other person like us has dignity. The other person like us is a creation, one may say, that has value in and of itself, that even though we don't suffer, we should nevertheless extend, if you will, empathy to this other creature. Peter Singer's been writing for years about animal rights. He's been pretty successful in winning converts. Unfortunately, all those converts are human. He hasn't been successful in getting animals to respect animal rights. Now, how am I doing on time? All right.
Okay, let me just say that that last line about I haven't got animals converted, you know, maybe it was good for a laugh and a hand. I think it's cheap, I have to say. I think it's seriously cheap. Why is it cheap? Because I never thought I could convert animals. I know that animals are different from us. I know that animals are not capable of listening to rational argument. It's implying that somehow I've made some sort of mistake where I never had. Of course that animals are different from us. Anybody who's read my work knows that I don't think animals are the same as us. I simply think that they have interests, they're capable of suffering, and we do wrong when we ignore their interests simply because they're not members of our species. It's also incidentally wrong to say that animals don't care. I think, again, anyone who knows dogs well will know that they do care about what happens to, perhaps what happens to you. There's many anecdotes about many different species who care about their own kind and others. So caring is not part of theism. They're not theists. Caring is something that is natural to us. Now, it's true that it may often be more limited. It may be true that since we are beings who have higher rational abilities, we can care more universally. Nothing in that that's contrary to assumptions of Darwin or of evolution, that we are rational beings who can understand better than non-rational beings what it's like for someone in Rwanda to suffer. That's certainly true. It's nothing contrary to evolution or Darwin in that. And incidentally, when Dinesh says, well, the Christians will write checks and the Buddhists won't, I suspect that's a slur. What's certainly true is that three of the greatest philanthropists in the history of the United States and the two greatest living philanthropists in the United States who have given more than anyone else to fighting global poverty have not been religious. I'm talking about Bill Gates and Warren Buffett. They have given vastly more than anyone else, vastly more than any Christian in the history of the world has ever given to fight global poverty. And the third person I was thinking of is Andrew Carnegie, who also, in terms of inflation-adjusted dollars, would be close to being up there, though not quite, with Gates and Buffett. Also not a religious person. So there's plenty of atheists who help, and I certainly believe we should do a lot more to help. So a lot of my writings has talked about what we ought to be doing to help the hungry and the poor in the world. And I give a substantial portion of my income to do that. I dare say that I give more than 99% of Christians in this country give. And I know that many other people do as well. Now, look quickly at the arguments. It's not actually clear that our universe has a beginning. Dinesh says this, and he talks, of course, about the Big Bang. But if you really look at what a physicist says, physicists are really talking about the known or observable universe. If you talk to physicists who study the Big Bang, and I've talked to Professor Lyman Page at Princeton University, who is one of the greatest experts in this area. In fact, he's the one who, through measuring cosmic background radiation, has done more to precisely date the Big Bang than anyone else. And he will acknowledge that he's just talking about the universe that we observe now. He does not know, and science does not know, what happened before the Big Bang. But I think it's clear that there was a universe. It's hard to imagine nothing existing and the bang occurring out of nothing. And it's possible, as some have suggested, that there's a constant oscillation of expansion and collapse of the universe. So the universe may well, I would suggest, probably has existed forever. And if it hasn't, of course, you have to say, Dinesh has to say, that God has existed forever. But that's just as implausible, just as difficult to imagine, I would say, as the universe existing forever. So there's certainly no favoring for a theistic view there. At best, it's a tie. The universe is supposed to be fine-tuned for life. Well, very briefly, not necessarily so. A lot of scientists think, again, Lyman Page thinks, that these claims, that, like the one from Hawking that Dinesh quoted, are simply false, that you could vary these things quite a bit. and you would have perhaps different universes, but you would have universes capable of life. And of course, since we are here, we know that we live in a universe that is one capable of supporting life. Otherwise, we simply wouldn't be here to observe it. We leave it at that. Thank you.
We're now going to move into cross-examination. If you've never seen this before, let me just explain a little bit about it. Each of the debaters will ask the other questions and will rely on their gentlemanly attitudes to keep their responses to the point and short and allow the other person to ask a question after they're finished answering. We will start as our usual pattern. Dinesh D'Souza, why don't you ask the first question in the section of cross-examination? We'll go on for about 15 or 16 minutes with this.
Let's begin. I want to come back to some of the themes I raised at the very beginning, because you've sort of ignored them, really, and move on to talk about suffering and other things. So let me ask you this question. Let's assume that society moved in the direction that you want. We're a secular society. We've eliminated the idea of God. And now someone proposes a law to deal with some of the people in our society who are physically and mentally handicapped. And the law basically says that if you've got people who are so handicapped that they don't have their full faculties, they can't live a very meaningful life, and they have no family, they have become dependent on the state. So the idea is to get those people together and give them all lethal injections. And this is a proposition that goes before the Supreme Court. They call you in to offer not just legal, but also ethical advice. Would you advise against this, and if so, why?
Well, as you have described the law, I would advise against it, but you haven't described it very precisely. Because you've talked about people who are handicapped or intellectually disabled. You haven't said, for example, whether they are infants,
Let's make it more precise. Let's take people who have Alzheimer's disease, who in a sense have no real comprehension of life. In that sense, they've lost, as you say, not only the ability to consciously enjoy the past, the present, they have no projection in the future. Let's say the proposal is lethal injection for all people with Alzheimer's who have no family. Are you for it or against it, and why?
I'm against it because people with Alzheimer's have had a period of life when they have been, like you and me, capable of deciding how they want to live and how they want to die. And if they fill in a statement saying that when they get Alzheimer's, they no longer want to go on living, I would be in favor of passing a law that said that someone could give them a lethal injection when they reach the point that they have described in their document, you know, before witnesses, perhaps with a cooling off period, come back to it a week or two later or something like that. I would be in favor of a law that allowed someone to do what they had requested under those circumstances. But I would not be in favor of a law that ended the lives of people who had had a chance to think about that and who had not requested that form of ending their life.
But aren't you injecting new data into my example? I was talking about people who haven't made any such statements.
Yes, well, that's why I oppose the law.
Okay, so you would require... Okay, go ahead. Now it's your turn.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, you said that I had not responded to the questions that you said in your beginning, but that's because I thought we were focusing on the existence of God. I don't believe that you have responded to the argument from evil, the argument about suffering. You did say that this is not original, that indeed it's in the book of Job. I know that. You did say that, well, it presupposes that we care, and you think Darwinians shouldn't care. But there's a lot more I can say about that. I think we are capable of caring. We have empathy for others, and we have the capacity to extend that to strangers because of our higher cognitive abilities. So many of us, even though we're atheists, do care, and that's understandable. You still haven't told me how it can be that a world with this kind of suffering, not caused by human free will, could be created by an all-powerful, all-knowing, and all-good divinity.
Well, first of all, it seems to me that this argument is less an argument about the existence of God and more an argument about the nature of God. In other words, you seem to be saying, if God did it, he's really a mean God, right? You're not challenging the existence of God. You're simply saying his character is, from your point of view, deficient, because if you were God, you would have done it differently.
I started off by saying that I thought we were debating the Christian or Judeo-Christian concept of God. Isn't it true that that concept does mean that God has the attributes that I mentioned?
Well, our debate is God, yes or no. We're exploring the implications of theism and atheism. And so we, as we discussed earlier, we can interpret this any way we want. Now, I'm happy to address the points you raised. Look, in a sense, you could say God could have created a lawful universe, or he could have created an arbitrary universe. A lawful universe is a universe which operates according to physical laws. Science would be impossible if we didn't have a lawful universe, for example. So you seem to be suggesting God would have done better to create a discretionary universe in which, for example, if the ocean tide is rising and a tsunami is brewing, God jumps in like a cosmic bellboy, puts a stop to it, right?
That's one possibility, but I can think of others which would have eliminated suffering or greatly reduced unnecessary
suffering. Is it possible to eliminate suffering and still have a lawful universe, according to you?
I would have thought God could do that. It would be, you know, pretty easy, I would have thought, for an all-powerful being to create a...
Pretty easy.
Yeah, I would have thought so.
You would have thought so. Okay. Look, see, I think that in criticizing God, and the Christian God in particular, you first have to articulate the Christian understanding of the situation and then criticize that. It seems to me you're creating, if you will, an atheist God and then knocking that God down. Here's what I mean by that. From the Christian point of view, we are pilgrims on this earth. Our life is short. Eternal life is the ultimate destination. And so suffering and earthly suffering is not the be-all and end-all. In a sense, if a child has cancer and God were to jump in and fix the cancer, that child would still die. So if you say that God's ultimate concern is not simply terrestrial death but salvation, then from that point of view, none of this has the quality of self-evident refutation that you think it has. The larger question becomes, what is the larger pattern of human destiny? And so from the Christian point of view, all you are doing is saying that because there's earthly suffering, when earthly suffering is not the final picture, nevertheless, that convinces you, but only within an atheist, a pre-existing atheist framework, that there is no God.
Can I respond, or is it your turn for a question? I don't want to jump in if...
Well, let me take my turn, and then you'll have yours.
Okay, all right.
I want to come back a little bit to Gates and Buffett and the Carnegies and so on. First of all, Carnegie, as you know, wrote very explicitly on Christianity. His book, The Gospel of Wealth, for example, talks specifically about stewardship, Christian responsibility. But even Gates and Buffett, are you denying that these men are a product of a Christian civilization, Christian education? Are you denying that the assumptions of Athens and Jerusalem are imbued in our culture so that even secular people would be exposed to them? Are you denying that in some senses modern philanthropy, which by the way is a real peculiarity of Western civilization, in many other cultures people accumulate enormous wealth and don't feel any obligation to give any of it away, let alone most of it away. So this impulse, I think, historically, philosophically, can't be understood divorced from its religious foundations, can it?
Look, of course it's true that Buffett and Gates are the products of a Western civilization which has been dominated for the last 2,000 years by Christianity. You actually said, interestingly, Athens and Rome, and of course I think it's true that the influence of Athens, ancient Greece, has been important. And for Aristotle, magnanimity was a virtue. That is, and that includes, you know, giving things away, being generous, is part of that. Not exactly Christian compassion. I would agree with you with that. It's a different conception. But it's nevertheless significant, I think, that these people, both of whom have said publicly that they don't really have a lot of time for religion, they're really not interested in it, have been the ones who have undoubtedly given most of the wealth. So I think it's clear that, you know, though Christianity may have been a good influence in various ways, I'm not denying that, and some things of it are noble and should be picked up and preserved, it's clearly not necessary to be a believer to be among the greatest philanthropists of our time. If I can now come back to what you were saying about suffering, you said it's not the be-all and end-all, that's salvation, we only live here for a short time. Look, even if I were to accept that, I would still think it was a bad thing that there is this unnecessary suffering in the world, in these, you know, children dying painfully unnecessary. And most of us do believe that, because of course we do our best to stop it. So that suggests that we also think the world would be better without it. Yet, it's still there. But even if I were to give you that and say, okay, it doesn't matter for beings who have eternal salvation, you kept talking about humans. You have still not addressed the point that animals suffer too in this world. And I don't think you believe, or Christians believe, that they have an eternal life and have the prospect of salvation. So, well, you still haven't explained why animals suffer in this world.
Well, earlier you chided me, but the point